America, we are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. At Grand Canyon University, we believe in equal opportunity, and the American dream starts with purpose. To serve others in ways that promote human flourishing and create a ripple effect of transformation for generations to come. Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
Spin your passion into a business with Shopify and break sales records with the world's best converting checkout. Let's hear that one more time. The world's best converting checkout. Shopify's legendary checkout makes it easier for customers to shop on your website, across social media, and everywhere in between. Now that's music to your ears. Any way you spin it, you can be a smash hit with Shopify. Start your dollar a month trial today at shopify.com/records.
Good news, everyone. Talking Futurama is coming back for Talking Futurama Season 2, Part 2.
Fresher than a summer ham, this podcast comes every Friday. And if you sign up at the $5 level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, you can hear each episode as it goes live.
That's right. Sign up today at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons for $5 to hear Talking Futurama every Friday throughout the rest of 2020 and also all the previous episodes we've done so far.
So head over to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons now, or we're going to clamp you.
Shut up and take my money.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where we promise all the sugar cookies and secondhand smoke you can handle. I'm one of your hosts, the disgracefully hilarious Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who else is here with me today?
Hey, it's Henry Gilbert, and I'm never throwing out my She-Hulk versus Leon Spinks comics.
And who do we have on the line?
This is Nick Prueher. I'm driving under the influence of being a jerk.
And today's episode is Days of Wine and Dozes.
I'm a tanked up loser? Is that how you see me?
Oh, sounds like a certain loser could use some tanking up.
Today's episode aired on April 9th, 2000, and as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Oh boy, Bobby, Nintendo sells its 100 millionth Game Boy / Game Boy Color Metallica file suit against Napster, and in a big moment for comedy nerds, the More Cowbell sketch airs on Saturday Night Live.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it was a big weekend for...
A legacy of unfunny people quoting it.
Yes, yeah.
Over the next 2 decades.
Our entire lives of a good... It was the great sketch that then everyone had to say all the time.
You know what this podcast needs? More cowbell.
Yeah, when the shirts started showing up at Target, that's when you knew it was over.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like it completely... Like, he'd hosted SNL before, but I felt like that made Christopher Walken, like, the comedy star after that sketch. I also heard our friend of the show, Scott Gardner, who's also an amazing, like, sketch comedy writer. He worked at Funny or Die with a person who worked on the Cowbell sketch, who... That guy was like, yeah, everyone works at Funny or Die because they saw this sketch in high school and started writing their own sketches. Like, it was that influential of a sketch. And it is funny.
It's a funny sketch. It's really, really good. I think I was there the night it aired.
Wow.
And I was just like blown away by Christopher Walken having a really hard time reading those cue cards.
You know what? There's a sketch that's really similar that happened during the Chris Farley era where he's in the recording studio and is recording the Monday Night Football, like the whole season's worth of Monday Night Football jingles where it's like, are you ready for some football? And he's playing Hank Williams Jr. And he's doing Bengals and the Dolphins coming out tonight. Packers and the Vikings coming up, and the people in the sound booth are making fun of him, and they really hurt his feelings, and then he sings a soft ballad rendition of Are You Ready for Some Football, and to me, that's the better sketch.
Oh, I looked that one up.
Oh, man, yeah. I never saw that one.
Yeah.
Man, I need to look that one up.
I do feel like Homer, though, like Homer after listening to the Rap and Ronnie Reagan tape, like, oh, he does say well a lot. Whenever I hear Don't Fear the Reaper, I'm like, oh, there is cowbell in this song.
You can't unhear it. You're right.
I didn't see it live. It was one of those early internet, your friends saying, you got to see this, dude. And it was like in 2000 or maybe early 2001 where it's just we all stand around the computer and try to show each other something funny. funny, like that early experience
on your real player.
Yes, I got to assume more cowbell was put on like Style Project or something that my friend was taking me to, or some other
Consumption Junction, perhaps.
Oh, maybe that one. Yeah.
Ho.tv.
Fark.
Fark. Of course.
And the Game Boy, like I bought at least three Game Boys, with two Game Boys and one Game Boy Color, and that began a whole like lifetime of me buying at least like three of every Nintendo console that was portable at least.
They're
I think I have
cool.
like four or five 3DSs. Sorry.
Yeah, I think I just had two. Only two 3DSs.
Aww, loser.
I think I did have three DSs though. Three DSs. Game Boys, I actually resisted getting the Game Boy SP. I was like, you're not getting me this time.
And SP?
Then, or, yeah, wasn't that the bright one? Was the SP with the clamshell closing thing?
Oh,
or,
Game Boy Advance.
Yeah,
yeah,
sorry,
Game
I
Boy
mean
Advance.
Game Boy
okay.
Advance. Yeah, yeah.
And I still call everything a Game Boy, except for the Switch. I called the DS a Game Boy, and people made fun of me. But it's a Game Boy.
It's fun to call it a Game Boy. I prefer, I mean, and they wouldn't have hit 100 million had it not been for Pokemon. But, yeah, a whole decade of Game Boys, and...
Or the Walkman. Walkman had to walk before the Game Boy could game.
Oh, and Metallica suing Napster. What an uncool thing like that. I wonder if that still like hurts their reputation, or if people are just like, they're just a cool band now. They're not like corporate guys suing a company.
Speaking of that early internet video stuff, that reminds me of those web cartoons that were making fun of Metallica. The Napster band.
Yeah. Oh, that was like early Jib Jab, wasn't
it? It was like literally the cartoon, like actual drawn cartoons.
Oh, okay.
And you could buy like T-shirts with Napster band on them and stuff. And it was James Hetfield and Lars were the stars of those cartoons.
Yeah, that's right. Hetfield's
I recently watched Some Kind of Monster again, the Metallica documentary, and I just couldn't. I can't not think of Lars as the anti-Napster guy.
Right?
He's likable in the movie. You know, he seems kind of like the voice of reason. But I'm like, but why were you doing that?
I can see it from a certain standpoint. If you're, you know, an egotistical rocker who is like, hey, they are stealing my music. That's my music, and they're stealing it. But I think most other musicians realized it kind of comes off as just, like, selfish on your part, of just you're a rich person demanding more money. Or, I mean, another thing with Napster is that a mistake people make with most piracy is thinking, like, well, if they pirated that, that would have been a purchased copy. Like, it not really. I mean, you know, hey, look, piracy, not good. Don't do it. Blah, blah, blah. I'm saying that. But parody jest. But I mean, you know, Metallica, of all people, incredibly rich people complaining about it. And if they're going to be mad at somebody stealing from them, perhaps their record company should be the first one they're mad at.
I think so.
Not Napster.
Yeah. It also reminds me of the Weird Al song, Don't Download This Song, where I think he says even Lars Ulrich thinks it's wrong is one of the lyrics to that. So.
Well, according to Napster, Weird Al wrote every song.
That's right. God, yeah.
Including the famous Donald Duck blowjob clip.
That's right. See, Weird Al had much more reason to sue them because of all of the fake Weird Al songs that were on there.
I'm glad you brought that up, Bob, because one time for my birthday, Joe, who I do the Found Footage Festival with, made me a compilation of all songs downloaded from Napster that were Weird Al Yankovic, but spelled W-I-E. Weird was spelled wrong, and then it was Yankovic. And I believe Oops, I Farted Again was on there, and a sketch about Yoda smoking pot, and all the classic Weird Al hits.
You knew if there was weed or swears, it was not Weird Al.
Yeah. Of course.
I guess actually, you know what? Napster did sort of give us Facebook, at least if the film Social Network is to be believed. So, you know what? Maybe we should be mad at Napster. I'm changing my mind now. Hey, welcome back to Nick Prueher from Found Footage Fest.
Thanks for having me back, guys.
And as of this recording, we are in late August, and recently you just kicked off the Kickstarter for Life on the Farm, a new documentary. Can you tell us all about that?
Yeah, we are in progress on this documentary, and basically Joe and I were doing a Found Footage live show in Milwaukee, and a filmmaker who's from England originally came up to us afterwards and said, can I show you this video? And you know, like you're talking about how everyone was gathered around some kind of device saying, here, look at this funny video. That is the bane of our existence. You know, like we do a show where we show funny videos that we found physically at thrift stores and, you know, lovingly curated. And then somebody's like, dude, you got to check this thing out. It's insane. And it's like a fake German forklift video that somebody found on YouTube. They're showing it to us at a table after a show, and it's like, you know, come on. This is a rare case where it was actually worth watching. This guy, Oscar, brought his laptop and he showed a VHS tape that his grandfather, he inherited from his grandfather after his grandpa died. And it was his neighbor, a farmer named Charles Carson in Somerset, England, was an early pioneer of video technology in the 80s. I guess using the technology. He had a video camera and he would use it and make titles and then film the titles and overdub his voice and make these kind of crude videos of what life was like on his farm. And it starts off, you know, fairly normal, and it gets very bizarre. He shows how the cow, at one point he holds up the placenta of a cow who's just given birth and says it's lovely. And his parents are on the farm. Life and death happens on the farm, and he's very cavalier about it. I mean, it's just a fact of life. So he has a funeral for a cat, and it's I've seen a lot of strange footage and, you know, 30 plus years of collecting VHS. This is the weirdest VHS tape I've ever seen. So the filmmaker Oscar has been, you know, we came in and agreed to help get it made, and we've been helping guide the documentary as he's gone to the farm, interviewed the man's relatives, and tracked down even more footage of this really unique, eccentric man from England.
I recommend our listeners go and check out the trailer. It's compelling. And I just realized while you're telling this story, you are living that Mr. Show tape trading sketch.
Yes, yeah.
It's exactly that.
20
it's
plus exactly years later, that. You're still living it.
I know. It's exactly what it's like. Oh, and, you know, one of the other things is, like, there's this whole death positivity movement going on right now and people talking about being okay with death. And this Charles Carson guy, the subject of the documentary, was actually way ahead of his the times at that point in the 80s, because he just, you know, life and death were a matter of fact on the farm, so you get used to it very, very early.
And I also totally identify with that annoyance you have when somebody is showing you, like, they promise you a cool video and they're like, no, this is real, and then as you're watching it, you're like, this is a sketch, this isn't real, this is a sketch from some other country or whatever, and you realize this guy got tricked or whatever. That always bugs me.
Yeah, and if you're in media like we are, you get better at sniffing it out, but you know, people get better at fooling people as well. So
yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that's the scary part. But occasionally you do find good stuff, so you can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. You got to listen to people. They're very excited to show you something, and you just hope it's something real.
You guys are like a sieve for the world of content that was put on a videotape, and you find all the good in quotes stuff out there.
Yeah, we try. We've just been doing it so long that I think people know our sensibility now, and so we get boxes in the mail. I just opened one today that was had a tape in it that somebody found called How to Beat a Speeding Ticket. And one was called, the other one in the box was called What Me Juggle? And it was an instructional video that came with juggling scarves still in the package.
Oh, that's wonderful.
It's like with Mystery Science Theater, when that was on the air, people assume, like, what happens when you run out of bad movies? You guys are the same way. It's like, it's bottomless. The VHS market is bottomless, the amount of things that were produced.
That's what I realized. And thrift stores, you know, we can't really go to them safely right now anyway. But even when we could, they're seeing fewer VHS tapes being donated. A lot of them are just ending up in landfills because nobody's buying them. But even we have 11,000 tapes we've collected, and we haven't gotten through even a third of them yet. So we have enough to last us for a long time.
And which people can see on your VCR party live streams that are still going even in these times.
Yeah, we've started doing that. We've started doing another show on Saturdays, which I think you guys will be interested in, called Shatterday Morning Cartoons. And I feel like there isn't appointment television for Saturday morning cartoons. It has been for a long time. So we're going to watch forgotten cartoons on VHS with various special guests, and air those at 10 a.m. Eastern time on Saturday mornings.
All right. I'm watching the next one for sure. Yes. Oh, man.
Yep. If you want to see the Garbage Pail Kids cartoon or Laverne and Shirley's cartoon with Mr. Cool and Fonzie and the gang, join us.
We're both laughing. For whatever reason, the Laverne and Shirley Join the Army cartoon keeps coming up on our podcast.
I can't believe, I have to
laugh.
It's
so weird.
It keeps coming. It's just, we're in this weird thing where it organically comes up like every three podcasts now, I think.
I remember watching it. It must have been in reruns, but I remember doing an impression of Mr. Cool, Fonzie's dog, and as a kid. So I don't know where I saw it, but it stuck with me.
I remember him being like a Muttley-style character.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I don't think talked in words. I think it was all sort of gibberish.
Mm. A lot of like hand over mouth. I almost put my hand over my mouth as I said the hand over mouth laughter that apparently all dogs do in cartoons.
He was the original Poochie.
Less to animate that way, right?
I guess, yeah, if you cover the mouth and lip sync.
Oh my God, like a cartoon that takes place in the pandemic.
Oh,
no lip sync. No lip sync at all. Saving so much money.
I guess, Nick, were you watching this episode live when it came out in 2000?
I was. I stuck with The Simpsons as a regular Sunday night viewer from Tracy Ullman all the way through, I believe, 2004. Which is when we started going on the road a lot, and I was not at home on Sunday. So, I would watch every Sunday, and I was at this time was collecting a lot of the Simpsons playsets, the talking Simpsons playsets.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I remember I was working at the Letterman show at the time, and my coworker and I were obsessed with those. And there was a website, Entertainment Earth, that would always have the new ones that came out, we'd call down to Toys R Us in Times Square and find out if the new set came out. And after work, we'd go down and I'd pick him up one of each, and we'd grab one of each, and I just hoarded those playsets.
Just building your two-model set of Springfield in your basement or something?
Yeah, and then my girlfriend at the time was like, we have a 400-square-foot apartment. We cannot have all these playsets. And so I remember going to a comic book store and selling them all and being very heartbroken
about it.
Honey,
the kitchenette is Springfield now. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, I know.
You can just eat sitting in the toilet or bathtub, just do that.
That was my suggestion, I remember watching this one live and then being sort of blown away at the continuity of, oh yeah, Barney's still sober in the episodes, and thinking that was kind of groundbreaking.
Yeah.
At the time, like, King of the Hill was the cartoon making these big continuity moves. Simpsons wasn't really into this outside of the stuff that Bill and Josh did in 7 and 8.
Yeah, well, though, in season 11, they're starting to take the big swings with, like, Apu not only married but has 8 kids.
Yeah.
And a few episodes ago, Maude has died. And now here goes Barney into sobriety. But
it was a weird spring of 2000.
Yes, yeah.
What is your thought, like, what do you think about that? Because I know, like, Joe's dad loves The Simpsons, and he was very against the idea of the characters changing permanently in any way. And I sort of, as The Simpsons as comfort food, you don't like that either. But as somebody who's written for TV, it's so stagnant to have to reset every week too. So I could see that you'd, as a writer, it'd be more fun to have things permanently change. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it does feel weird because The Simpsons is such a static show that change does feel alienating. But I mentioned King of the Hill earlier. Like, I think they did a good job of, like, every 18 months introducing some kind of new element to the show, either a character, goes somewhere, or a baby enters the picture, or there's some sort of growth spurt or a new job or something that kept new stories happening. And I think that helped the show stay good until the very end.
I think with every change, the main question, and I think the writers at least ask themselves when they make this choice on the change, even if I or others might disagree with the results of it, but I think they at least ask themselves, like, are these jokes getting stale, and would making this change make us have better opportunities for better jokes? And, like, I think they felt with Maude, well, partially it was about not liking the voice actress quitting the show, but also I think they were like, what do we do with Maude? She's just the boring wife. Like, there's nothing there. Maybe we can find new jokes with Ned if he's a single guy dating around. And same deal with, like, Apu. Oh, if Apu's like the new married guy, the newly married guy, and the new father, maybe there's more jokes they can do there. But as Bob had pointed out very well in that episode, it's like they kind of wrote themselves into a corner and barely used Apu after that. And I think Barney might be one of the worst examples of that for comedy's sake, because every joke with Barney is about the heightening of alcoholic tendencies. When you take those away, if he is just a functional man who has no problems, he loses a lot of the comedic potential he has. As important it is that somebody gets sober and you want to show a person succeeding at getting sober, you lose opportunities for jokes.
Yeah, I think with this change in particular, it took something away from the character. I will bring up A Millhouse Divided in season 8. That change actually gave us two functionally new characters, like Kirk and Luann Van Houten had basically no personality. I think Kirk's like one line today was "Get off our property."
Yeah.
He became a character in that episode, as did Luann. They became like defined characters.
Yeah.
So that gave them something. In many of these cases, it's taking characteristics away that we like.
And also giving Milhouse jokes about being a divorced child, which were jokes they weren't telling before. And I don't know if this opened up as many Barney jokes of like, I felt like every Barney appearance after this one, until he just became a drunk again, there were jokes about, they weren't even jokes about it. It was like, oh, and you're at Moe's Bar and Barney's there drinking coffee.
And his hair is combed.
His hair is combed. He doesn't have much to add, you know?
You're right. It's in how they do it. And I think like, you know, as much as you want characters from a narrative standpoint to grow and be interesting, there are some characters in The Simpsons that I just want to be comedic. Like, I don't need to know about their inner life. I don't need to know anything other than come on for a few jokes, be a sidekick. Like, the family, you know, explore their emotions. I think they've been able to do that with a few other characters, but Barney, the town drunk, just seems like he should have stayed the town drunk.
Yeah, I agree. And I did want to talk about Barney as a character just to sort of explain who he is and where it came from. I'm sure we talked about it before, but Barney is one of the many elements of the show that was intentionally a throwback in 1989. Like, remember when old sitcoms had crazy drunk characters? Wouldn't it be like not politically correct if we did that? And that's what they did, along with all the other choices, like, you know, Bart being a Dennis the Menace style character with a slingshot, like all of these 60s and 50s tropes in a late 80s, early 90s show. And Barney is one of them. And Barney is essentially, this is like such before our times, Barney is basically Crazy Guggenheim from the Jackie Gleason show. And Jackie would have these sketches on his show where he'd play a bartender. Then this guy called Crazy Guggenheim, played by Frank Fontaine, would come in and like tell these crazy stories and talk in Barney's voice. And then Jackie be like, I think I heard somebody put a coin in the jukebox. And then he'd sing in this beautiful voice, like a very melancholy song.
That's why Barney does that in the B-sharps. Yeah.
So I have a clip here. You can at least hear him tell like the beginning of a joke, and I'll tell you when to cut it off because it goes on forever.
Remember the pet shop on the corner where we used to walk by and see the monkeys in the windows and everything? They're tearing that down.
Yeah. I'll never forget that. Boy, one day I went in the show to get my mother a birthday present.
Oh, they had a lot of nice things to get in there.
Yeah. I wanted the best for my mother. You know how it is. I went in there and I said to the clerk, Marty, I said, give me that parrot. That's the one I want. Beautiful looking parrot. He says, that'll cost you $20. I said, so what, a parrot?
Okay.
So
that's basically where Barney comes from. And like, it was a crude character for 89, because like Cheers was an incredibly popular sitcom about a bar. Nobody was ever this drunk on Cheers. Mm-hmm. There was no crazy drunk character on Cheers. Maybe like there'd be like an extra character in the background or something, but like Norm or Cliff or Sam or Carla or Frasier, they were functionally like half drunk in the show, but no one was talking like this and slurring their speech.
They were all functional alcoholics on that show. And comedies would more have a very special episode about an alcohol problem, not a recurring character who has a drinking problem and just everyone accepts it.
Oh, there was also Otis the town drunk, of course, in the Andy Griffith show, who was one of the funniest characters. And I thought, like, you know, the good part about him is he never got sober. He was always like locking himself up because he just knew, you know, he should be in jail. And then I was reading about it before recording, and then Return to Mayberry, the 1986 TV movie, he got sober and became like the ice cream man of the town.
Aww.
So everybody tries to make their alcoholic characters not alcoholics anymore.
Yeah, I mean, it came from a time when being an alcoholic was more socially acceptable. Like, that's just, you know, Sam, he's a drunk.
Yeah,
that's
the
what he does.
Old drunk guy, talked more about like, oh no, alcoholism is a horrible disease and people need help with it. Yeah, so Barney was an intentional throwback of that kind of character. Plus, it's giving Homer the Fred Flintstone of the show. show, Barney.
That's
his
yeah.
friend too, except this one is drunk. Well, also in the early seasons, he's a bully to Homer. He's not as easily cowed in those early seasons.
And as Lenny points out, he makes Homer's alcoholism seem less monstrous, right?
Exactly. Yeah. All of that. That's the. I think some of my favorite stuff in this episode, that anything Barney does to get help is something Homer needs just as much. But he's like, hey, I'm not as bad as Barney. So he doesn't need that help. But yeah, it's also funny seeing that Gleason clip, because, like, I don't know, I feel like I look at Jackie Gleason, I'm like, you're probably pretty sauced right now too.
Oh, yeah.
Buddy. but that's just the 50s, that everybody drank like fish then.
I was like, the lighter side of alcoholism. That was sort of like a whole character trope in the 50s and 60s.
When in real life, that character would like fall leaving the bar and crack his head open and die on the pavement. Yes. There's nothing funny about it.
We just did a bunch of research into like Disney's classic animators, and a couple were like, oh, this guy was a raging drunk, and it's like, what happened to that guy? Well, he drank himself to death, or he had a car accident and died. Like, that's why he didn't do anything after 1959. Did you ever wonder why that was?
The Simpsons will be right back.
More exciting than dogs playing poker, this week's episode was brought to you by our cool guest, Nick Prueher. We thank him so much for coming on, one of our best friends of the show. Definitely follow him and the Found Footage Fest, all the cool stuff that the Found Footage Guides do on their Patreon and on their YouTube channel. Check it all out. And also, if you enjoy this podcast or our sister podcast, What a Cartoon, you should know that signing up at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons is how me and Bob are able to do it as our full-time jobs. Supporters at Patreon, $5 a month, they not only know that they help us out and keep on living, but they also get a ton of exclusive content. Right now, they could be hearing every Friday a brand new Talking Futurama, where me and Bob cover a different episode from the second season of Futurama that was airing at the same time as season 11 of The Simpsons. And you'll get access to all of the previous miniseries as well, where we cover shows like Mission Hill, King of the Hill, previous episodes of Futurama, and The Critic. All of them are yours at $5 a month at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. You know what's awesome to listen to while taking helicopter lessons? That would be the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, our extra premium podcast that we do each month for our $10 and up subscribers, in addition to all of the $5 stuff I just talked about. Each month, me and Bob do a podcast that is sometimes even over 4 hours long about a different animated feature film in the same style as Talking Simpsons and What a Cartoon. We just covered Wallace and Gromit, Curse of the Were-Rabbit, a ton of stop motion fun there. We chat about cheese quite a lot. Previous ones have been Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island, Ghost in the Shell, Aladdin, A Goofy Movie, Beavis and Butthead Do America, The Iron Giant, and tons more. You can hear over 100 hours of classic What a Cartoon Movie podcasts and a brand new one each month if you're a $10 and up subscriber at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons.
But I guess we should talk about the writers of this episode.
Yes.
As part of this very long preamble. So some new guy, Dan Castellaneta, never heard of him, never wrote anything before, but he wrote this with his wife, Deb LaCosta. And of course, Dan is Homer. Of course, I was pulling your leg out there, everybody. Mm-hmm. I was pulling so many legs. But yeah, Dan wrote this, and the story goes that he and his wife wrote this original script. The way Dan tells it was he dropped it off to Al Jean the day of the table read of Duffless.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I guess he didn't know what the premise of Duffless would be, and Al was like, previous showrunner Al Jean with Mike Reese in season 3 and 4, was like, you know, this is a great script, but it is too similar to Duffless, a show about Homer you know, going on a 30-day hiatus from drinking. So we can't do it now. So they waited 7 years and basically did the same thing to Mike Scully, is like leave it on his desk and surprise him.
Yeah, as we talked a little with Mike Scully about this in our December 2017 interview. If you're on the Patreon, you should check that out in the archives. But he mentioned like how it was kind of terrifying for him for a little bit in the morning to come in and see like basically the lead voice actor in the show wrote a script, and if you don't like it, you've got a real problem on your hands and you're gonna have to deal with a star who wants to make their episode. But he was like, oh no, this is really funny. Like, so he they decided to go through with it. I mean, it also too is like that, I wonder if Castellaneta had extra confidence in doing this because this was right after the pay dispute thing. So he was like, oh hey, we asked for more money and we got it, maybe it's time to push for that other thing I've been thinking about too.
I think so, and it does help that Dan really defined Homer. Like, so many of his ad-libs made it into the show as dialogue we remember, and he just, you know, he is the voice. It's going to be very hard to replace him, but yeah, he is not just some random guy writing an episode. Like, he, so much of him made who Homer is the way he is.
He's, I mean, Krusty too. Like, I think Homer, Homer and Krusty are like two of the best cartoon voices that ever were. And I think too, it shows that Dan is incredibly good at improvising in character. And also, you know, you got Barney and Willie and Quimby and Mel and Gil, like all these amazing voices he does. Like, so it makes sense that he could at least like write. I mean, Simpsons scripts are so heavily rewritten anyway that, I mean, why not let him write a script that they're going to heavily rewrite instead of, like, you know, somebody's Harvard buddy, perhaps.
Was Dan there when you guys went to the table read?
Yeah. It was something else.
Did he do any improvising? Do you remember?
You know what? I think he made a couple of, like, there was like a fight scene that happened in it, and in character he had to make like fight noises. That was pretty funny.
I think there were like a few fun comments he sprinkled in just to make people laugh, but nothing like super ambitious.
So that was
I remember that too, because I went to a table read and Dan was there, and he would make asides or things that I feel like were just trying to make the table laugh that weren't in the script when I was following along.
Because he is like a true performer too. Like, even though he's like, you know, in his plain clothes and wearing a baseball cap and just reading a script, I think he still has the want to perform in front of people. Like, his background totally lends itself to that. I looked up some of the stuff. So he was in Second City Improv, and I wondered, like, who did he do improv with? Because, you know, lots of people work for Second City, but they were in, like, they had, like, even back then, five different troupes. So just because technically he was in Second City the same time as Stephen Colbert doesn't mean that he knew Stephen Colbert or worked with him. But the ones he mentioned that he worked with a lot were like Richard Kind of the Famous People, Richard Kind, Rich Hall, Bonnie Hunt.
Oh, Mo himself, Rich Hall.
Yes. Oh, man. Yeah, wonder if he suggested, like, hey, you know who was ugly? I worked with Rich Hall.
Make him look like this ugly guy, you know.
and also he went to college and did college radio with UCB founder Matt Walsh as well.
Oh, so awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he didn't have any like professional TV or movie writing credits before this outside of one sketch for the Tracy Ullman show. That's all I found from him. But he and his wife would go on to write 8 more episodes between 2000 and 2018. Maybe even more in the future. I don't know what their plans are. But yeah, like after this, they wrote, I guess, like the wraparound stuff for a clip show.
Yeah, that's not Gump Roast isn't the best episode.
No, let's not parody Forrest Gump in 2002. Yes, let's not do that. And then they went on to write a lot of actually good episodes.
Yeah, they wrote the Artie Ziff Returns episode that I thought was a pretty good new Simpsons episode. And by new, I do mean 15 years ago.
Yes. but yeah, he and Deb have been married since 1987, and they're still together. They met in a Chicago improv class.
In 82, their relationship is as old as we are, Bob. That's how... she's a writer and performer in her own right too. This isn't just like give a favor to the actor's wife. Like, they've been writing and performing together for, like, you know, close to 20 years by the time this episode aired.
Yeah, and you can hear some of the sketches they wrote on Dan's CD he put out in 2002 called I Am Not Homer. I've never heard it, so I can't attest to how good it is, but I assume it's on YouTube or whatever, like every old piece of music is, or album.
I listened to one where Deb plays a radio show advice host, and Dan plays a series of silly characters who call in and ask about problems, and it's fun. It's a fun, I mean, when I hear them together, I'm like, if you guys got together now, you would be a popular improvisational podcast married couple.
Yeah, like, they'd be like on Comedy Bang Bang every month.
Totally, yeah.
And I was looking to see, like, what has Deb done, like, acting-wise, and she was, like, in one episode of Tracy Ullman, and then in some Dan adjacent stuff. Like, she was in one episode of Aladdin doing a voice. She's actually doing a ton of incidental voices in the Back to the Future cartoon. Mm. So, like, just Dan probably got her into it because they needed somebody, and she's obviously talented. So, yeah, like, but not a lot of stuff outside of this.
Oh, and she was a copywriter at the same ad company as John Swartzwelder.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Damn.
I remember Dan said that on an old commentary, but I was watching like a Dan interview about how he met Deb, and he was mentioning like, yeah, at the time she was a copywriter in Chicago and working with John Swartzwelder in the same building, so which is really crazy.
So I mean, IMDb kind of undersells their writing abilities because they don't count like radio, and that's where they were doing a lot of their writing, and like on the stage too.
And also I turned up one other interesting thing. They worked together on The Simpsons, which was in the early days of The Simpsons comics. So
that surprised me.
It was published in February 1994, probably written late 1993, which actually would time out to around when Duffless was being worked on. So I'm wondering if they submitted that, and after it was turned down, they're like, hey, Matt, we want to write a comic book instead. So this was a backup comic in Simpsons Comics 3 called Krusty, Agent of Clown, which is an 8-page full-on, like, panel-for-panel parody of Jim Steranko's Nick Fury Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. comics from 68. And it's very involved. If you didn't read those comics, I think it probably makes zero sense to you, I think.
I just remembered looking through this trade you have, Henry, like every Simpsons comic in the beginning, at least, was just like a reference to the 50s or 60s, like, yes. Tales from the Crypt or The Amazing Colossal Man, things like that.
I had actually asked Bill Morrison about this on Twitter before. Bill Morrison was one of the artists who drew that comic. And I asked, like, oh, how involved were Dan and Deb? Because from the credits, I thought it could just be like, it's just a series of names. It doesn't give story by or whatever. I thought maybe Dan and Deb just said, hey, you should do like a S.H.I.E.L.D. thing with Krusty. But here's what Morrison said when I asked him. I believe Steve Vance did the plot and Dan and Deb scripted it, but it may have been the other way around. In either case, they were very involved. So,
cool, that's great.
Yeah, it's if you want to look it up, it's in the first Simpsons comics collection. It was Simpsons Comics number 3, but it's the backup of it.
Unfortunately, not in the Matsumoto era, so I can't read it.
I think it's a good thing that they wrote together and did so many plots together. I think it's, you know, similar to how on live action shows, eventually most of the cast directs an episode. Like Bryan Cranston directed a lot of episodes. Aaron Paul directed episodes of Breaking Bad. Like, it's just kind of what ends up happening for these stars on popular shows. They want to diversify their skills too and work on stuff that they couldn't otherwise. So yeah, I think, I mean, is it a little bit of cronyism? Perhaps, I guess it's not, but I think this was a fine script of
I think so
too. And also one other behind the scenes thing before we start is that I believe that Scully said in our interview he didn't want to say this was definite, but as he remembered, he's like, I think Dan Castellaneta was also just getting a little tired of Barney and playing Barney drunk, and like that he I mean too, Bill and Josh, they wanted to put Barney in jail at the end of and write him out of the show at the end of Who Shot Mr. Burns.
That's right, yeah.
Like, they were already tired of him at the end of season 6. So.
Yeah, I was thinking, like, I think Barney, like, his greatest hits are really in the first 4 years of the show, and then he was really used sparingly. Like, did he have any plots after Deep Space Homer?
I'm scratching my head for that.
I'm sure we're forgetting a big one, but
I mean, there was the film festival.
That's true.
Don't cry for me, I'm already dead. But I guess he wasn't the lead in that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I think, I mean, it was, whenever he'd even get a joke in episodes, I was like, oh, Barney got a joke. Like, I guess he made Homer go to New York City by stealing the car. So I think that was in the season 9 season premiere. So that might be the last time he was that plot focused. Like, just two episodes ago in Pygmalion, he is just like a silent creature who's like a prop, really. He doesn't say anything. Yeah. Oh, and also on the commentary, the director of the episode, Neil Affleck, he brings up that like he has his own has had his own issues with getting sober and that he put that into the episode. Though the way he brings it up is like kind of uncomfortable because he's like, anybody else here have problems with drinking? Because I did and put it in the show. It's like maybe people don't want to talk about that in the commentary. And also, Scully mentions on the commentary and in our interview that, like, the original script did what a Simpsons script is expected to do, which is return to the status quo. Barney falls off of the wagon. And Scully said, partially influenced by, like, the extended family he knew who had problems with drinking, that he said, while it is realistic that someone would fall off the wagon after like a few weeks of going sober, it was too dark and he kind of wanted to hope for the best with Barney instead.
That's the socially responsible thing to do. I don't know if it's the funniest thing to do.
Yeah, you know, it's well, that's why eventually I feel like after this in the writer's room, they probably were just nudging each other like, come on, can Barney just be drunk? It'd be funny if Barney, the drunk guy, did a thing here.
The way they make him drunk is just very unceremonious. Mm. He just has an unrelated relapse in the episode. I think I'm spelling as fast as I can. I forget which.
Yes, that's right.
Episode. I think it's season 14. Let's see. 14, yeah, season 14.
That
so he's
quickly,
sober until February of 2003. So he's got 3 years of sobriety.
Jesus. Hey, it's better than some people do, you know? but all right, let's now at the 38 minute mark.
Hooray.
Let's get into our first clip here as Bart and Homer search through some trash.
Trash night. In France, they call it La Nuit de Poubelle. In Germany, it's Krapenfest.
I can't believe it only comes 52 times a year.
Quit gabbing and start grabbing. And remember, the best stuff is usually deep in the garbage juice. See? A new pacifier for Maggie.
Look here. Cardboard tubes.
Now we can have indoor plumbing, just like they's got at the women's lockup.
They spoilt you, Brandine. Sometimes I don't even know who you are anymore.
Looks like Milhouse's mom finally threw out his blankie. He'll pay a lot to get this back.
Especially when we send it to him piece by piece.
Milhouse is an OG brony. I forgot about that.
You're right.
10 years before the reboot, Milhouse.
The accuracy of that My Little Pony logo is striking to me. I'm like, wow, you just drew it. You just drew the My Little Pony logo on there.
Yeah, it wasn't Happy Little Elves. It was just My Little Pony.
You know, that's the thing in season 11. They're getting more into like, just name the thing. Don't make up a thing for it.
I guess the Teletubbies show up soon.
The Teletubbies do. Amber making, Reynolds as
making
well.
Their third appearance in this season, I think.
You're right. Yeah. Wow. And Homer's French apparently translates to Night of the Bins. So, I think Krapenfest is not a real German word. But I don't know. You folks in Germania tell me otherwise.
Did either of you guys have blankies?
Oh, yes. Yeah, I did have a blankie I held on to until 13 or so.
I don't recall. I think it was more like a stuffed animal, but I think the Peanuts cartoon brainwashed generation into like, well, every child has a blankie, right? And we were just given them.
Well, so my blankie was one with like balloons on it, and I did sleep with it every night, but it was more like I just placed it on top of my other blankets, like just a stack of blankets, so I could say like, no, I don't need my blanket. But if it was taken away from me, I would have said no, don't do
it's
that.
It's not a crutch, it's something you've come to rely upon to live.
Yeah, I think I had a blankie too. I was a blue blankie that had kind of a silk border to it that I would always like, you know, it was like a self-soothing thing. I would touch the little silk end of the, but yeah, I think I got rid of it around 5 or 6, but I love that blankie. I would take it to, if we were going to a restaurant with my family, and yeah, I think I would have been upset too if somebody threw it away.
And was sending it to you back piece by piece. That's also... and I also like the implication that Bart and Homer just do it every week. Every week they go through the garbage garbage together.
It's a good return of the term garbage juice, too.
Oh, God. Yeah, that the zoom in on the green liquid dripping off the pacifier made it extra disgusting. And also a very dark joke that Brandy never knows plumbing until she is put in prison. Then it's Henry's time to shine because it's comic book talk time.
Oh, I did a bit of research, but I figured you knew all this.
Oh, yeah. I had to look this up for the specific dates, but yeah. So comic book guy is throwing out the She-Hulk versus Leon Spinks comic, which, just so you know, Leon Spinks, he made the news in 1978 because he got a shocking split decision win over Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, it was sort of like a Buster Douglas style move where no one expected it, and that was the height of his career.
And he never, I mean, Ali beat him the next time, and it's just a series of losses after that. So the implication is nobody would buy that comic because Leon Spinks is a loser. Nobody wants to read his comic book.
Hey, I had Buster Douglas boxing for Sega, so I will defend any one-time win boxers.
That's right. He got that game deal right before his big loss. That's why Sega Genesis signed up for Evander Holyfield right after that.
The boxers in that game were just massive. They scared me.
They wanted that game because they're like, oh, he beat Tyson, and Mike Tyson's game is on the NES, so if we have the game of the guy who beat Tyson, then we beat the NES.
It was one of Sega's stable of celebrities alongside Tommy Lasorda and Michael Jackson.
Yes, yeah. Before they got Sonic, they just were like, can we have every celebrity? But so this parody, though, of a crossover is actually based on a real crossover comic from 1978, the same year that Leon Spinks beat Muhammad Ali, and that is Superman versus Muhammad Ali, which I don't know if you guys have read or looked into it that much.
I was looking at some scans of it on Google Image Search, as far as I got.
It was a big event comic at the time because not only was it, you know, the fictional idea of like who'd win in a fight, Superman or Muhammad Ali, but also that like it was drawn by Neil Adams, written by Dennis O'Neill, who were like the A-level folks working in DC Comics at the time, and like they drew every possible celebrity they could on the cover. If you want to see the celebrities of 1978, they are defined as being on the cover of that comic book. But and in that comic, so space aliens invade and force Muhammad Ali to fight Superman because they want to know who'd win in a fight. Superman gets depowered, so it is a fair fight, and Muhammad Ali knocks him out. And so that is who would win in a fight. Muhammad Ali would defeat Superman.
And that book came out like right after he lost the title.
Yes.
So yeah. It wasn't that big of a deal.
I guess it was less of a big a deal, but I mean, Muhammad Ali still was famous and stuff. Mm. But yeah, it came right after the Spinks loss. So the specificness of that, and also knowing that like most of the writers on the show are comic book dorks, I think it is a very intentional joke there.
Well, speaking of superheroes crossing over into the real world, I wanted to ask Nick if he ever asked David Letterman about meeting the Avengers.
No, I didn't. My very like minimal interactions, that didn't come up.
Oh, jeez.
It's too bad.
Because,
I mean, there's proof.
Yeah.
I'm looking at all these drawings right now.
He got to ask Wonder Man questions, and Spider-Man webbed his hair.
What were some of the other, were there other crossovers like that?
Oh, the classic Obama Spider-Man one?
There is
that's
one.
That's the one I'm thinking of.
But around the same time as the Letterman one was, it was the Avengers meet the original cast of SNL as well. They did that comic.
Ah.
And of course, before that in the 60s, Jerry Lewis just had a series of comics of just Jerry Lewis where he'd fight the Joker on occasion. So there's been a number of celebrity superhero mashups, but I just don't get it for kids. You know, they're not actually meeting because you're looking at a drawing. Like it's a drawing of a celebrity meeting somebody. It just doesn't feel the same.
I also don't get the Jerry Lewis comic book. Like, you know, what's funny, drawings of Jerry Lewis.
Yes, drawings, not his voice or anything like that.
Well, that for this Saturday morning cartoon show, we're going to watch an episode of the Police Academy cartoon. And they have the Michael Winslow character in there who is doing funny voices, but they just dub in like a police siren with his lips moving. So the whole reason for his character is he could do funny noises with his mouth, and he's not doing those. It's a cartoon.
Oh, that's what I paid for.
What a mistake.
When I saw him in Spaceballs, I stood up and applauded.
Yeah.
We all did.
Also, the nerds rooting around through garbage. Bob got to see me do that exact thing when we got to take a tour of the DC Comics offices in Burbank, because at the end of the tour, they're like, hey, we got all these comics we're probably just throwing away because we got too many comics. You want to just grab them or have some? And I'm like, I'm just searching through it desperately, like, little free comic books.
It was Pearls Before Swine for me. Yes, if they had old Mad magazines, I would have walked out there with a box.
We get a quick joke about Homer wearing a sports bra. Like, this is not too far removed from his large chest jokes done in the Alone Again Natural Diddly as well. Homer used to be like just his gut poked out. He didn't really have like a large chest, but now we're in the man boobs comedy years here. I mean, this is after Fight Club, so it's
that's true. Yeah,
more mainstream than ever. And I also wondered, did Castellaneta himself choose to make all these jokes about hairy Italians? Because
he's lacking some hair somewhere.
it's his jealousy coming out there. Yeah, he must have thought, I mean, okay, he joined Second City in 1979. He must have thought he was getting on SNL, right? Like, that must have been his dream. Like, he's like, oh, I'm the next Bill Murray, but like his hair left him even faster than Bill Murray, or he didn't invest in the hair plugs Bill Murray has. I don't know.
I've never seen him not bald.
Yeah. And then we get a Bob's Big Poi comedy joke. That's not bad.
That's cute.
Yeah. And
I just miss tiki bars. They're fun.
I know. Yeah. This felt so L.A. to me as well, these tiki bar jokes. I mean, I guess tiki bars are all around. Are there a lot of them in the New York City area, Nick?
Yeah, there's a handful of them. You know, you get a $26 cocktail that comes with a ceramic Buddha mug you drink out of, that kind of thing.
I'm there for the tackiness.
Well, though, also the talking tiki feels like a reference to the Disneyland's Enchanted Tiki Room as well.
Okay, yeah.
And Homer references the Billy Ocean song, get out of my dreams and into my car. And then comes a joke about leaking gas, which Marge and Maggie should be dead walking through a wavy kitchen. Oh, that's so crazy.
It's a great Marge line. Like, they're so wavy.
And a great animation effect on the waviness too as she comes in. Yeah. And but yes, Homer has gone drunk with fiery god power here.
I don't remember the air in the kitchen being so wavy. Good Lord, that's gas!
Behold, I am King Talky Tiki! Hey, Flanders, can your god do that?
Actually, Homer, you and I worship the same god, so...
Irregardless, I am your god now!
Homer, you can't just reroute the gas line. Do you know how dangerous that is?
Do not anger Talky Tiki. I am all power. I'll be at most.
This is one of the more insane things Homer's done, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
I do like him saying irregardless. That's just a funny fake. That's like a Harvard word joke a little bit of like, because irregardless... I guess it is officially a word now.
It's
actually
officially a word.
Yeah.
Still bothers me. Still bothers me.
It's like the people who want you to say champing at the bit. It's not going to happen. Mm-hmm. You can try. I'm going to say chomping.
I love chomping all over those bits. It makes more sense to chomp on a bit than champ on it.
People that say primer instead of primer, get out of here.
Well, it also like... I feel like Bill and Josh would have frowned on Homer just lighting everything on fire and screaming at people.
Running away?
Yeah, he literally leaves his house to burn down. And like the way Marge just is like open-mouthed, you're running away from a fire that's moving towards the house.
It's a show about an alcoholic, this one, but it's not Homer. Homer set that lawn on fire and then is going to get drunk.
Yes, yeah. And on the DVD, there's a hidden deleted scene that shows Marge... puts her foot over the fire moving through the hose to cut off the gas. And so that explains that there's no fire that spreads. And they put out the fire by turning on a sprinkler Buddha. It is a Buddha that is a sprinkler as well. So.
I thought we were missing a scene of Marge like taking care of it. It felt like that was missing.
I guess they liked it better of just like the smash into the next scene. Like, you know, and Homer runs away and leaves a fire. Like, he's that big of an asshole. And also the I'll be at Moe's transitioning to the next scene. Like, that's out of the Helen Hunt episode as well of Homer. In that case, actually, that one was Homer leaving Marge with a problem of water. Now it's fire. So.
What element will be next?
I like the whole thing of them finding garbage and that leading to the fire. But it could have been any. It doesn't connect in any way to the rest of the plot, like a lot of the later seasons. But, like, I got to go to Moe's could have been said for anything, and then it would get us into the regular plot.
It could have just started at Moe's.
Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
At any point, it could have changed. And garbage diving to Tiki Torchman also doesn't really connect too much either.
No.
Then it comes to the bar. Lenny has a funny opening gag that also is like, no, you're an alcoholic. This is a cry for help as well. Which that is the danger when you do an episode about how, no, these jokes about Barney actually mean he's in a bad place. Then you think about, like, well, wait, what about those other jokes about being drunk by other characters? Should we be worried there too? Like, how much should we laugh? It becomes kind of the question then.
I mean, again, Lenny points out they're much more functional than Barney.
Yeah. It's true. They all can hold down jobs.
He puts things in perspective for them.
And I also love the use of all of the times they say glum in this next clip too.
So he says to the cop, no, you're driving under the influence of being a jerk. Hey, Barney, what's with the glum face? You glum or something? Huh, glummy?
You know, it was my birthday last week and no one remembered.
What are you, nuts?
I threw your party at my house. You lie! Why would I not remember my own birthday?
Huh. But we did have a shindig for you, Bon. We even videotaped it. Look.
And then, Nick, in your time with VHSs, have you found anything of someone filming a mail carrier?
Nothing like that. We did find one at an estate sale in Queens that was an old man wearing like a dress, like looking into the camera and dancing to the Phantom of the Opera soundtrack. And then it cuts abruptly, and then it's the same guy behind the camera recording somebody demolishing his house, or demolishing the house across the street like a construction worker. And he gets into a classic Queens expletive-laden argument whether he's allowed to film that or not, and then the videotape ends. So it was just a weird home movie we found in a video camera that it leaves you with more questions than it answers.
He had a lot of interests.
You know this guy better than his family did.
I think so.
This is a difficult needle to thread here that I think the episode does pretty well. But, like, they want you to feel humanity for Barney here. They want you to – they give him a realistic thing of, like, an alcoholic blacked out and they don't remember something. And they're frustrated at you telling them that. Like, all of these things, but it's also like, I don't know, what you ask yourself, why do I feel bad for Barney now when I was told to not feel bad about him going like, I'm supposed to be the mayor. why do we feel bad now? But I think it's just starting it with him thinking everybody forgot his birthday, at least, like, that puts you in an empathetic place for Barney at least. And glum is a funny word, you know?
Glummy.
Yeah, glummy. What's on tape, too, is just, like, very realistic.
Oh, yeah. Having aged, like, 20 years since this aired, I definitely recognize this in a lot of people I've known over the years.
Right.
And hopefully not myself. I feel like when I am drunk, I am either sleepy or wanting to show people YouTube videos. That's my attitude. I don't get belligerent or become Professor Bob or, get sad. So I think I lucked out there.
Drinking makes me too sleepy I feel like by a fourth drink I am like, I need bedtime. I don't have much tolerance for it, despite you think, you know, I got a few extra pounds on me that could soak it up, and yet I really can't handle it very well. In our lives, I've experienced folks who, like, then have done the things I saw Barney do in this episode that I didn't know when I was 18 and watched it the first time.
Yeah.
And it is very well, I mean, it's as far as a comedy about observational material, it is very observational of people with drinking problems and what it's like to be around them, especially at a party where they have the permission to be more drunk.
Yeah, I think of the phrase Professor Barney over and over with people I've known in my life, especially when Barney Barney as being as racist as they'll let him be on TV.
Yes, yeah.
And I love the his response to Lisa, no, I'm not.
That is, see, that is one of the most painfully real moments in the episode. Yeah.
Yeah, it reminds me of the They Might Be Giants song, Your Racist Friend, a little bit. Like,
exactly.
Yeah, somebody's at a party, and they let the contents of the bottle do the thinking, and they start telling you things that are couched in, you know, what does he say? Everybody has a different planet they can live on.
And we'd all be happier, yeah.
I've had that thing with family members of extended family members of saying, like, you're making me uncomfortable with what you feel you think you can say now. And then he's like, no, I'm not. No.
Actually, the one before this was Bart to the Future, right?
Yes.
Like, I feel like deadbeat Bart also has a lot of the alcoholic traits I recognize in people I've known over the years. Like, everybody, I know how to do everything. No one will give me a chance. Everyone's out to get me. And something Homer says later, also, I've heard people in my life say, like, I could do a lot of things if I had some money.
Yes.
That's I'm laughing out loud at that quote.
Why don't we hear a little bit of Professor Barney here?
I'm just saying that when we die, there's going to be a planet for the French, a planet for the Chinese, and we'll all be a lot happier.
Mr. Gumball, you're upsetting me.
No, I'm not. Gee, is that what I look like when I'm drunk?
You wish. That's the stage we call Professor Barney. Talkative, coherent, even insightful. Here's drunk.
Well, I'm off to market!
Marge, you're making a complete fool of your... it's just Barney.
It's also strikingly similar to the David Hasselhoff video that his daughter made of him eating the burger on the floor. This, which I think did push him to sobriety, I believe.
I think so. It's funny that whenever someone has to dress up as Marge, there's always a blue wig in the house.
How do they have so many? I mean, we've established before Homer got those free blue wigs.
Free wig with purchase of large wig.
That's right. the professorial position of somebody who's drunk like that, that is one of the more frustrating type of person to be around when they're drunk.
Yeah,
because...
especially if you're just like, I'm here to like hang out and have some drinks, not be lectured.
Right? Yeah, it's at least some alcoholics might be at least like chummier to you and they're the life of the party. But the one who is just so like smugly full of themselves and like, all right, time to tell you how it is to everybody.
Here's what you're doing wrong.
Yeah. Yep.
I had that. We played a underground film festival in Sydney, Australia a couple of years ago. And a filmmaker afterwards at the after party clearly had a few and started telling me about how 9/11 was an inside job and it didn't really happen the way you think it did. And I was like, I was in New York then. I saw the second tower come down. Don't tell, you know, I was like in this argument at a... supposed to be a fun, you know, like, and the conspiracy theories came as soon as like three drinks in, had to get away.
Oh boy. Yeah, that's we didn't know when we were watching this young, like my friends, when I was 18, I didn't even have any that heavy, or 17, I didn't have any heavy drinking friends at all. Like I am lame in that I didn't even have my first drink until I was like, I believe I was 3 months away from turning 21, and my friends were like, you should really at least drink before you're 21 once so you can say you didn't wait until the day you were 21.
Like, I didn't really start drinking until I was 21. I had some drinks before that, but it was such part of being, like, social in the Rust Belt area where there's no hope. Like, yeah, most people's dads were drunks. Like, just incredible drunks. Violent, raging drunks. I had a friend, it's like, where is this kid's dad? He's just in this closed room drinking all the time. Not good. So, yeah, like, I would eventually, like, a lot of people in their 20s just like, well, here's the one day of the week I'm going to be catastrophically hungover. It's always Sunday, so no plans on Sunday. And then you realize, like, that's kind of fucked up. I shouldn't, like, arrange my week around when drinking will disable me.
I mean, but this is a problem, though, with... exaggerate. Once you come into these jokes about like Barney feeling bad about himself, you start thinking, should I feel bad that he like that I laughed at when he drank paint thinner, you know, or wakes up as a member of a sailor crew or whatever? Like, is it funny? Is it not funny now because it's about a joke about blacking out or being a embarrassing drunk? But they never gave having Barney reveal like a mild mildly xenophobic, let's say, tendencies through that. That's extra dark too. Like that, that's an unlikable. They didn't want Barney to say something funny. They wanted Barney to say something that makes you very uncomfortable with his observation.
Say it to a child too.
Yes, yeah. Having Lisa be the one to react to it too, that also is like, no, it's not funny. It's not, this isn't supposed to be funny. You're supposed to feel bad.
Yeah, and I still don't know how to feel about that. I mean, on one hand, I should be able to adapt and like, okay, now I'm treated to a character and have to look at him in a different way, and it's forcing me to do that and think about whether I laughed at, you know, him smoking a cigar with the cellophane still on and hallucinating and, you know, like, but I some part of me just wants him to be that guy who does funny one-off, you know, jokes about him being drunk. So I still am a little bit conflicted about this episode.
Yeah, he's kind of like Grandpa Simpson in that he will just be written into a scene to give it a punchline.
Yeah, yeah.
Or to sweeten it a little bit.
And if then they did it would be comparable to just doing a regular episode of like, no, Grandpa actually is senile and we need to deal with like yeah. real senility. It's like, well, that's a bummer. Like, it's not. Well, and also that they follow it up with Barney going, is this how you guys see me? And everyone just points and laughs at him. And it's like, it's telling you, like, you laughed at him too. You're just as bad as his shitty friends who laugh and enjoy that he is. I mean, this also shows that, like, Barney has to fully extricate himself from this lifestyle. Like, he actually shouldn't still be friends with Homer after this or any of the other guys. If you want to look at this as a realistic situation. But yes, everybody's having a good laugh at Barney.
Oh, I'm a disgrace. Disgracefully hilarious. You passed out before we could even give you your presents.
I still got mine. Barney, I got you what no drunk could do without. Morning after stationary.
And I got you helicopter flying lessons. Can you imagine this booze bag at the wheel of a whirly bird? He'd be all, look at me. I'm a tanked up loser in a helicopter. anyway, happy B-Day, Punkin.
That's just so mean. And yeah.
Is all this helicopter joke stuff, helicopter lesson stuff, just like the joke is that you would not just get lessons, you would have to like go to flight school? It's like helicopters we've learned in recent years, very dangerous things.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. I guess I think it's at least a novel thing to think up of, like, what would force Barney to be sober? Like, what? Like, they could have given him scuba diving lessons and it would probably work the same, but, well, except it wouldn't, it'd have to lead to a heroic thing at the end that's different if it was scuba diving lessons. But I don't know how easy it is to take helicopter lessons. I have heard stories of like, oh yeah, you can just pay to be a co-pilot or whatever, like with an actual flyer, but I mean, Barney, I think in this episode, gets to fly a helicopter much faster than most people get.
That's true.
Yeah, it could have been, you know, just like the joke could have been like, here's some heart surgery lessons, you know, just like, what's the worst thing that you could give to a drunk? But helicopter leads to a more filmable conclusion, I guess.
And then Barney comes to a realization in this next clip.
Hey, where you going?
I'll show you. I'm going to take these helicopter lessons.
Wait a minute, Barney. You gotta be sober to fly. I mean, it's not like driving a car.
Then I'm gonna quit drinking. No, I mean it. You won't see me here again, ever.
Wait, that ain't funny. He's my best customer. Well, the handwriting's on the wall. To stay afloat, this bar's gonna have to go queer.
You mean it's not? Oh. Wrong again, gay guy to Springfield.
I forgot that this had that gay joke.
Yeah. Well, we know there's a lesbian bar in Springfield.
That's true. Yeah. It needs to. Well, and how can Mo even compete with the Anvil, though? That comes back in this episode, actually.
It's true. The return of Roscoe.
Yeah. But it also, Dan plays a lot of gay characters I had forgotten. I guess it's old when this episode comes out, but Bob, you just shared a really good video about Married with Children that reminded me of Dan Castellaneta's appearance on that show.
He plays a gay man who Peggy is cheating on his husband.
Yeah, with his Tracy Ullman fictional husband, Sam McMurray.
Yeah.
That's maybe too the stuff about him having writing with his wife. Maybe that was a surprise to some people who had seen Dan play gay so many times, like, and earnestly too, not like as just a, well, this was him playing a very extreme stereotype, but
in that episode of Married with Children, there's no like affectation or anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's supposed to be a regular guy that Al's like, wait, you're a gay and a regular human?
I remember the Tracy Ullman sketches. I don't remember the appearance on Married with Children, but I think that Tracy Ullman was one of the first times I saw like gay characters on TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was the first for me too. And the joke about them is that they just have regular married couple arguments between them, like that it isn't really jokes about are gay people weird. It's more about the normalcy of their situation.
Yeah.
And I also think Homer saying it's not like driving a car, which again, it's like these are cries for help from Homer. Yeah. But if I may complain about continuity here, when Mo says Barney's his best customer, I don't feel that the history of the show supports that. I thought it's more often that Barney is like a loser with no money who has to like get other people to buy him liquor. Like for example, the Mary Poppins parody, it's him in the gutter begging for money to get more alcohol.
I will bring up the fact that is a song sung by Sherry Bobbins.
Oh, okay.
So she's creating a scenario about the booze hound.
And they always lie to you through song.
Exactly.
I hate that.
Exactly.
Hate when people do that.
Sherry Bobbins is no better than a poo.
Well, all right then. I guess, I mean, there's no other. Barney must pay him actually a bunch of money now. I take that back because in 22 short films about Springfield, there's the joke that Mo says he has calculated Barney's bar tab at NASA, but it is to such an extreme amount that it's not actually real. It tricks Barney to handing him $2,000, and Mo's like, oh, yeah, I'll take that, showing that it was a scam. So actually, Barney does give him lots of money.
We just don't know where the money comes from.
Yeah. Well, hey, he's got all those ears on his back for a reason.
It's all that medical testing. You're right.
But okay, I take it back. Barney could be his best customer. Comes back from commercial break and Barney's already cleaned up his act. He's tucked in his shirt. He has somewhat cleaned up his filthy apartment, combed back his hair. He still has the quivery lip and teeth sticking out, so not everything's better. But and I really like the drawing of him looking through those empty bottles there. I think these moments feel like Neil Affleck, the director, getting through his own experience of getting sober into the character of Barney, especially his looking through, like, just tossing out all these bottles.
And we haven't seen his apartment that often in the show, and it's moved locations since then, but it's not quite as messy as the last time we saw it. Like when we saw it in season one, it was just like a Where's Waldo picture. It was so cluttered and full of crap.
And but he'd never lived above Mo before this one either. But
great joke though. Great joke.
I love he says we. That's extra funny to me. Realizes he can't do it. He's already jonesing for it. And him asking Homer for help it's a good gag of like, Homer is a terrible sober buddy. You should never ask him for help. You should get an actual sponsor, not your drunk friend.
His first step is to truly enjoy a beer in front of Barney.
And I think on the commentary, Deb LaCosta, she brings up this was partially inspired by a scene that stuck with her for its tragedy of that Homer's the one who got Barney his first beer and turned him into a drunk. And in the when he was going to go to Harvard, like Barney was on track to be a Harvard valedictorian even until he got drunk.
I want to bring up something from his house that I forgot about, which is he takes off a framed picture from in front of Duff that says thank you Barney. And I feel like that's a great piece of merch. Like somebody needs to make that as a framed picture you could put in your house.
Oh, that is good. Yeah, I'd want that. I'd hang that right next to the Bart holding up the word balloon to Homer that says I smell that.
Exactly. It could be a pair.
So Homer decides he's going to help Barney, and that's when they head over to AA, which is instead AAA, that's a joke.
Our third mention of East St. Louis so far.
Yeah, you're right. We had just heard an East St. Louis reference again in Missionary Impossible, which is all because they made fun of East St. Louis in They Save Lisa's Brain in season 10, which led to infuriating the city of East St. Louis, so then they decided to mention it two more times.
Yeah, I don't know. know, and at this point, it seems like there's a bit of a racial context to it, too, you know? It struck me as odd hearing it in this episode.
Yeah, I mean, then also that the writer of that episode defended it of, like, it's a crack-ridden slum was what he said in the news. I'm like, wow, that's...
Yep. Problematic.
Well, and then we head over to AA and we meet many characters who have had drinking problems in the past.
I'm glad they put in Susin from scenes from the class struggle in Springfield. She definitely had a drinking problem.
And Kurt Van Houten had before that too, but I know there's one that you've been waiting to see this, more of the quiet alcoholism of a certain character throughout the series is here in this group. Mrs. Hibbert, she's just sitting there.
You know what? I didn't write that down, but yeah, that she, this is Bernice, I think.
Right, yeah, Bernice.
She got an act break in the Homer versus the 18th Amendment. That's like the act break is her passed out in the chair.
When they find out that it's prohibition is installed. Yeah, I think that's the only she drinks too much joke in the show. Yeah. But yeah, it was funny seeing her there. I'm glad somebody remembered she has a drinking problem. I don't think Kent has a drinking problem more than any other celebrity. Like, honestly, it should have. If I could replace one character in there, I would replace Kent with Melvin Van Horn because he got whacked out on Wowie Sauce. For a second, I thought the two big guys in there were Gyro and another guy from American Gladiator, but they're just there to beat up Gil, so I think they're just large men,
They're two toughs.
Hired goons.
I wonder if those guys, once they gave up alcohol, their new addiction was bodybuilding, and that's why they're so huge. But yes, Homer and Barney head to AA.
Welcome back, Homer. I see you finally hit rock bottom.
Not a chance. I can sink way lower. I just came to help my friend Barney.
We all know why we're here, don't we? To keep ourselves sober and to network. So let's get started.
Well, after I lost my third job in 2 days, old Gil was in a pit of despair.
And that's when you realized you were an alcoholic?
Oh, no, I never touched the stuff. But you don't have to be drunk to know the value of Amway. Now, this is used crankcase oil, which you ladies know is murder to clean up, you know. And company's coming. Ah, oh, you're doing this at the worst possible time.
Ah, your finger's in my eye.
That's a good, I like that fingers, your finger's in my eye. That's a good random thing for Dan to add in there. I still don't really know what Amway does other than being very rich.
Amway is a big, giant, multi-level marketing scam in which you sell your friends things they can buy in stores, but for more money.
Okay. I did look that up, and like they still haven't been found, like, it proven in a court of law to be a scam. Like, they're still... And also, they gave us Betsy DeVos. Like, she's...
Oh, I figured, like, one of the Trump people was an Amway person because you got your MyPillow weirdos every kind of scam people are running. I figured an Amway person would be there.
Oh, yeah.
I had, I think, an uncle who got into it at one point and was like trying to sell our family like detergent and things. And, you know, they might make a fine product. I think that's how they get away with it. Like, their products are fine. But like then it's never about buying the products, about getting you to sell for them, you know, which is like any pyramid scheme does. And so eventually I think my parents were like, hey, we love you. Just don't bother us with this stuff anymore.
The Wikipedia said in 2018 they made $8.8 billion. Like that's how big Amway is. I think they own some stadium. I'm not a sports guy, but they own some places called the Amway Center. I know that. I also love that Gil's not even there. He's just there to sell stuff. He never drinks. And they also they say it's based on real life of like if you go to AA or Narcanon in Hollywood, some people do just network there.
Oh, it's a parade of stars.
Even though it's supposed to be anonymous, but I guess if you're, you know, a movie star and you're there, how anonymous can you be?
I have so many friends who are AA guys now. I think maybe it's just my age where people went through their phase. But I'm not a drinker. No one in my family drinks. And whenever I go to bars, it has to have something interesting to do in it. Like, even if it's like one of those like mega game, like erotic photo hunt or darts or, you know, the game where you put the hook on the ring on the hook or something. Like,
I hate that game.
Be, But if you're not drinking, you got to have something to do. I mean, what else are you going to do? Talk to people? So, but so now I think that's why I have a lot of friends who are AA, because you just, they'd bring over a lot of kombucha or iced coffee and we play board games and stuff like that. So, AA people, good people.
You know, I think the last time I drank in a bar was watching your show at SF Sketchfest.
Probably, maybe the same for me. I mean, I'm at the point of quarantine 6 months in now. Just like, I kind of miss going to a bar, staring at my phone and hoping no one talks to me. That's an experience I greatly miss.
Phones have changed it. Yeah, now you can do anything on your phone.
You know, I think seeing the X-rated Found Footage Fest stuff was like a version therapy for me now. I don't want to drink a screwdriver ever again.
You're going to have a negative connotation with any alcohol now.
When I taste vodka and orange juice in my mouth, I just think of like watching wound videos or live birth.
Well, you can thank us later.
But yeah, then Homer, you know, makes a very corny joke about taking 12 steps to a plate of cookies, which is at least funny that they like toss him out of the church, like beat him up.
The smash cut to him getting out of a bush is very funny.
And it shows that he's outside of the church, so it is the classic like AA is done in a church basement kind of gag too. Though that sugar cookie specific, I've never attended an AA meeting, but the jokes I've heard in AA meetings is stale donuts, not sugar cookies. Or what was it in I think it was donuts that they eat in Fight Club when Ed Norton's character goes to,
I think so, yeah,
to it. Yeah, that's what I think. Probably all these AA jokes, I was like, well, I watched Fight Club, so that must be what AA is.
Yeah, I've seen it in so many shows that I always think of Steve Earle being the AA leader, and then having one of those coffee machines with styrofoam coffee and cups, and everybody takes a break and smokes, like, kind of chain smokes cigarettes after the meeting.
But yes, it now comes to the B plot of the episode, which is Bart and Lisa hearing about a contest.
Hurt everyone.
Did Gaga just say hurt everyone?
Gaga, cute name.
The Springfield phone book needs a new cover.
It does?
Send us your snapshots, and if we select yours, you win a fabulous mystery prize. To enter, send your film to this address. Too quick? Try again. Did you get it? Here it is. Coming in from the left. Don't delay, do it today.
You think we should enter?
Well, it shouldn't be too hard to beat the old photo.
So it's Mr. Burns on the cover, tending his fingers.
Does that mean that he owned the phone company then with that? I wonder.
I guess he owns more than one utility. Mm. But yeah, these things are real, and the people are still doing like get your photo on the cover of the phone book things in 2020.
Wow.
You take a picture of the town, something in the town, you send it in, and that becomes the picture of the phone on the phone book.
Yeah. I don't think I've gotten a phone book. I had my old apartment that I lived in until the end of 2017, I would still get the yearly phone book, and I'd be like, oh, wow, still doing it, huh? But these days, since I moved this place, if it gets phone books, I never see them. So
I haven't gotten one in years. And when I got one, I thought of the Mitch Hedberg joke about getting a pamphlet. Like, here, you throw this away.
Yeah, this whole B plot seems like something out of a Dennis the Menace episode. It's very quaint. Kids trying to get their photo on the cover of a phone book, which I feel like even in 2000, people weren't really using phone books that much.
Well, you're right. This script as written would be in Dennis the Menace. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same. And that hurt everyone thing is extra weird to me, because like, okay, let's not fully go into it because we already talked about it before, but Jerry Falwell Sr., not the sexy junior. Ooh. Jerry Falwell, Jerry Falwell Sr. in 1999 was saying that Teletubbies was making kids gay, including subliminal messages was one of the things he said about it. And so I wonder if, because the lip sync's way off on that hurt everyone thing, and it just, something doesn't feel right about it to me. I wonder if originally the character said like kiss boys or be gay or whatever, and then they changed it to hurt everyone. I don't know. It just doesn't, something feels off about that to me.
It's a weird joke. It's also kind of a Family Guy joke.
It's pretty low-hanging fruit. Like, what if the Teletubbies were naughty? Like, they just did like two other Teletubbies jokes before this, but two or three.
They had Homer say, "I'm Tinky Winky the Teletubby, and I'm all man," despite what you heard. And then Homer runs away from Teletubby shooting lasers at him in Missionary Impossible three episodes earlier. maybe two in one season is enough Teletubbies jokes. You're...
Someone had a new kid and was pissed off at Teletubbies.
But yeah, you're right. It is a bit Family Guy-y, which is the worst thing a Simpsons episode can be, I think. I also like when you pause the address that it has a P.O. box, a room, and an attention you have to add to it, too. So there's so many ways you can get wrong the thing that's appearing on TV.
Yeah, part of the contest is actually writing down the address in time.
I think they must have been the only ones who got the address down, and that's why they end up winning in the end. And they head over to the memories closet, which is much bigger than it was in the season 9 episode Lisa the Skeptic.
I guess, did we ever go fully into it in that episode?
No, Homer just puts a thing, he puts it outside of it and then grabs the Billy beer. But this time we fully walk into it, and there's honestly too many to note, but one of the ones I really noticed was the motorcycle is there.
Oh.
That was just from like 4 episodes ago, and it made me realize like, oh yeah, Homer still has a motorcycle at the end of that episode, and it never comes back.
He won that motorcycle. The deepest cut I could find was Bart's sombrero from Krusty Gets Busted. It doesn't say Mexico in that episode. It does in this one though, but that's, I think that's where it came from. Either that or it came from the reel before the credits of Camp Krusty when they go to Tijuana. But in that case, the sombrero is not this a straw color. So.
Yeah, man, we were both playing Find the Sombrero thing. I remembered one other time Bart wore a sombrero, but it didn't say Mexico on it, and it wasn't frayed either. And that was when Patty and Selma are showing off their slideshow from their trip to Mexico.
Oh, that's Krusty Gets Busted.
Oh, my bad. Sorry. Okay. Well, I also like seeing Spiffy Cleaner there. That was my favorite, like, deep cut that... Homer doesn't buy in that episode, but I guess he bought it some other time. And if you don't remember, Spiffy was the cleaner that would clean the headstone of Edgar Allan Poe.
Oh, right.
And also there's a cup from Nero's Palace, from Viva Ned Flanders, their Vegas trip episode. That one I pulled up like, oh, that's the exact one. I think for some of the more recent ones, the animators are like, just pull a prop out of the pack from a previous episode and draw it in there.
I noticed a pig in there that looked a lot like Sir Oinks-a-Lot from Homer Goes to College. Mm. But so I wondered if it might be stuffed, like, you know, it's not alive. I couldn't place what that pig would be from.
It's right next to like a lobster trap too, but that's not where he kept Pinchy. So that's kind of out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Also, I don't know where they got a menorah from either, which I think is a joke. Like,
why did they steal Krusty's menorah?
A joke they do twice in the episode is Bart forgets that they are doing a contest. Like, he just, in this case, he starts dribbling the camera like a basketball. And then Lisa's like, Bart, the contest, like, contest.
It's a weird joke, the bouncing camera.
It's very strange.
It makes like Hanna-Barbera noises when it bounces.
Yeah, actually, I guess it should more make like a clonk sound or something there. And then Barney goes to take his tests. And we see a brand new character who's going to teach him how to fly, but he's talking to Arnie Pie, the only like regular character who flies a helicopter in the series.
No dialogue from him, oddly enough.
You'd think that Dan Castellaneta would have wrote in another line for a character he talks as. Maybe in his original script, he's like, and so Arnie Pie is teaching Barney how to fly. And then he just acts out the whole thing there. But yes, instead he gets, Barney starts taking his lessons from a very calm guy.
Elvis played a chopper pilot one time. He made so many darn mistakes. We were just laughing at him.
Great singer, though.
Oh, absolutely. You know who else I like is that Leo Sayer. Anyway, we're nice and level now. How'd you like to take the controls?
You think I'm ready?
Sure I do. One sec. Testing, black box. 1, 2. Ah! Ah! She's all yours, friend.
Hey, I think I'm getting it.
Yes, that's great. Now let's just pull ourselves out of this tailspin here.
Oh, I'm sorry about that.
It's okay. That's what the diapers are for.
Really good laugh on that.
I like the realism of it. It's just like, oh, sorry about that. That's all you can say after you like avoid your bowels in front of another person.
And after Barney barely gets the thing functioning as intended, he's like, let's try the hardest thing ever.
Let's
challenge you with that.
I love this helicopter pilot so much, this character, just his matter of factness, his horrible taste in music, and you know, just like, oh, absolutely, just kind of always talks in that same register. I for some reason it's kind of a nothing character, but it's Hank, right?
He does yeah, yeah.
Just really funny. He's, and on the nose. It's great.
He's okay to die and he's ready.
Yeah. I love how he's calm no matter what situation. And did you look up what movie they're talking about with Elvis there?
Oh, no, no.
It is a real movie, or at least he might have even been a helicopter pilot in more than one movie. But I believe they're referring to 1966 Paradise Hawaiian Style.
Oh, I figured it'd be Hawaiian in some way.
In which Elvis plays a helicopter pilot name, get this, Rick Richards is the name of the pilot. I'm not going to steal the joke from Sharpling and Worcester on The Best Show. They have a whole run of jokes about how Elvis character names are so weird that make you go, it's like the Arnold Schwarzenegger names for characters of its day, or this is Elvis, they should just name the character Elvis, but they're like, Rick Richards, that's a name. Yeah, same with like how Jackie Chan, whenever he plays a character not named Jackie, you're just asking yourself, why aren't you just calling him Jackie?
That's Jackie Chan up there.
Did you guys look up Leo Sayer at all?
No, what's his deal?
70s late rock musician, and you will probably recognize his hit was 77 hit When I Need You. It's pretty sickening, but I just like that the pilot liked him.
That he likes that and Elvis. That is weird. Yeah.
Also, You Make Me Feel Like Dancing.
Oh,
and Homer
right.
and Barney sang that in the 70s.
That's their favorite song. Yeah. Oh, you know what? Then Barney must love hearing this guy's a Leo Sayer fan. We have a quick cutaway to the kids trying to take a cute picture of birds, and then there's a joke about McBain being fat, which he says he's doing for a fat secret agent thing.
I think that's a reference to a fairly new movie, Copland, where Stallone famously gained like 50 pounds to be, get this, a fat cop.
You're right. You are right. Thank you for bringing up I was like, was this about how the closest I could think of, like, every now and then you'll see a story of like Arnold Schwarzenegger is kind of husky at the beach, but you're totally right. It's all about Copland. Now, you know, Stallone really thought he was going to get that Oscar for gaining the weight. He's like, all right, if I gain the weight and play a bad cop, I'll finally get that Oscar.
Yeah, I did not get that reference at all in this. I was just kind of like, I thought, is the joke that wouldn't be a good movie, that there's a fat secret agent?
that too. I think he's just lying, but yeah. It was inspired by the idea of like a Schwarzenegger style figure gaining weight for a role.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Well, and also, it's so ADR, so it was something else beforehand. The mouth movements are all wrong on Fat Secret Agent.
And, you know, I'm looking at pictures. He was so in shape in, like, 1996. Like, gaining 40 pounds, he just looks like a, like, slightly bigger in shape guy.
I heard Paul F. Tompkins tell the same joke about he made a similar observation when working with Matt Damon on a movie, The Informant, where for the movie, Matt Damon gained a bunch of weight for him. But Paul F. Tompkins at the end of the movie finds out he's trying to start losing the weight, and Paul's like, you had to gain all that weight to look like a normal person like me. Yeah, that Copland thing, it reminds me too that like Stallone, he couldn't get that Oscar even for doing the whole cancer thing with Rocky in Creed.
Even then,
he couldn't get that Oscar. I don't think he'll ever get it for acting. I think he did get it for and for Best Picture, he did get that. But anyway. Then Homer and Barney are hanging out. Barney lands a helicopter on their front lawn to ask Homer to fly with him, which is very crazy. And I forgot, too, that they have a quick little joke about Homer becoming the new Barney.
Hey, Homer. No, don't sit there. Take this seat right next to the tap.
But that's Barney's seat. Are you trying to make me the new Barney?
Hey, every bar needs a world-class drunk.
Someone who makes our alcoholism seem less raging.
Well, forget it, guys. I am not Barney.
See, Homer? It's not so bad. Now...
Hey.
You
dance for hours just because they told you to?
If I didn't, I'd lose their respect.
That's that Homer so happily gets bullied by his friends. Yeah. Or he just takes it. It's funny to me.
I mean, sometimes at a point in your life, you need that kind of person around to keep your own habits in check. It's just like we've all known that person where it's just like you're wondering, like, am I drinking too much? And then you go hang out with them and it's like 10:30 and there's already like a half drunk beer in their hand. You're like, probably not. I think I'm okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's a sign of a bad friend group that you hope, like, this is something you grow out of. But definitely, like, my 20s, I had, you know, well, friends who would say, well, I'm not as bad as that guy, so I'm not so bad, or I'm not bad. We all counted on each other to, like, cover for our own problems, just to be like, well, I'm not bad as that guy.
Yeah, you it's nice to have one friend who's a cautionary tale.
Yeah, yeah. That Homer so easily becomes the new Barney. I think they had these conversations in advance of just like, if we ever lose Barney, we all agree Homer's the next in line, right? Though those barflies should be the next, really.
I think so.
Yeah. Which they were at the party. They're in the party video. I forgot to mention that I was like, wow, Marge let the barflies into her house?
I think one of them is named Larry.
Yeah, and the one who calls me Bill is the other one. And so Homer is then invited on a helicopter ride with Barney, which then leads to, again, another like good observation of how it can feel like spending time when someone changes their life and then they spend time with an old friend and who liked the old negative patterns that were broken from that life. And it's a realistic tension between Barney and Homer here.
Oh, you missed some big changes at Moe's. He hangs newspapers over the urinals now. You can read the sports page while you pee. Very la-dee-da.
I've made some big changes, too. Can you believe I'm flying this helicopter?
Power lines! Power lines!
Whoops, sorry. When I think about all the time I wasted at Moe's.
Wasted? What about our staring contest? And the way we always knew what football coaches should have done. Remember the day we jumped that census guy and stole his clicker?
Those are all priceless memories, Homer, but I don't want to do that stuff anymore.
Oh, so you're better than me, is that it?
I didn't say that.
Take me home.
Oh, don't be that way, Homer.
I'll scream.
Okay, okay.
I gotta say, I've read more newspapers while urinating in the past 20 years than while not urinating. And in the wildly better country of Canada, I've been to several bars in which there was just like literally like an iPad screen in front of you at the urinal.
Man, I've never seen these things.
Yep. Well, we live in the bad country, so yeah, you gotta go up there to get that and healthcare.
I don't know if women know about the sports pages. If you go into a sports bar and they're just hanging there so you can read while you pee and get update on the scores. And I don't know if there's an equivalent like the inside of stalls for women on the inside of the door. I don't know.
I don't know. I've more experienced like funny cartoons in front of the urinals, though maybe that's me self-selecting.
You don't want to laugh. You're going to just be spraying everywhere. And Marmaduke gets into another scrape.
But it seems in England, we were on tour there last year, actually, right before this pandemic happened. We were on tour in England, and there's like one, they just have a lot of like peeing troughs in the men's room of disgusting bars there. But without fail, they advertise the food that the bar serves above the urinal while you're in the most disgusting urinal you've ever seen.
Oh, man.
I could go for some chips.
Oh,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's always like some kind of pork product or some sort of like savory pie that you can order at the bar while you're peeing into a gross trough.
Yeah, you know, maybe I guess, you know, the pipes all go to the same place anyway, but the troughs, if on the rare times I've seen them in America, I'm just like, ugh.
I really
intermingling with other pee. I just don't like that.
Ideally, I need the divider. Like a urinal is preferred, but divider, I'm in heaven. It's like I got my own little space.
This is the pains of being a man. But I really love Homer's stance on like the way we always knew what football coaches should have done. That's my favorite of his observations. Though Homer's I'll scream moment of like that edges up to a type of joke I'm not the biggest fan of. So but it's that Homer, but again, very realistic that like if you're still drinking and you're trying to stay friends with somebody who got sober, you are living very different lives now, and you're just going to find problems with getting back into your old patterns.
Yeah, and not even with drinking, you can be in either role. Like, either your life is going bad and you're kind of resentful your friends are doing better, or you're doing well and you kind of have to tiptoe around that.
Yeah,
if you're around someone who isn't doing so well, and but you want to talk about like the things you're doing, but you're just like, oh, I don't want to hurt your feelings.
Yeah, it's these are the pains of aging into long-term relations or long-term friendships with people. Yeah, but I know from experience, if you're somebody who's like, I don't want to drink at a party, or you just turn down a drink, everybody treats you as like a monster. You're just like, well, why don't you? Like, I know how a vegetarian feels at things.
Oh, yeah,
when
yeah.
you do that. So Homer runs home, and I do like that the commercial break joke is that Marge walks away from Homer just sobbing.
Yeah,
it's good. Rarely do they get to make jokes about Marge being insensitive. I like that joke. But it comes back from commercial break. Marge is reading Meddling Today in bed, which it's a good joke. I wish she was reading Sponge and Vacuum. I like Meddling Today comes with too much negative energy to it.
The 2000 Sponge issue is out.
I think the unspoken thing in Homer's anger is that I think Homer saying, oh, so you think you're better than me, is the closest they come to acknowledging it. But Homer, I think, is mad that Barney's sobriety makes Homer feel like a drunk. But I know if they approach that more, then it's like, okay, what do you do about Homer if you establish that he does have a drinking problem too? Then Marge has a great sad line of saying she hasn't had a friend in years. And then also she considers Homer her friend, and then Marge reveals he does not consider her a friend.
Yes, that's especially cruel.
And Homer then also saying like he hates Lenny and Carl, but then doesn't want them to know. That also works well of like, well, yeah, you should hate them. They're torturing you for being the new drunk in the bar. And I think for some younger people, the joke about OJ and AC seems like a non sequitur about orange juice and air conditioning. Yes.
The Falcon and the Snowman joke was lost on me until now when I actually looked it up.
Had to look that up too.
Yeah. It was a movie from 85 about two Americans that sold like government secrets to the Soviet Union based on a true story. No one remembers it, but Roger Ebert gave it 4 stars. So there you go.
It starts Sean Penn. You know, it's probably worth watching. I bet it's all right.
Yeah, I remember the title and nothing else.
And, I mean, though, honestly, I had to look up. I knew OJ was referring to Orenthal James Simpson, but I forgot that AC is Al Cowlings.
Oh, man. Yeah. He was like, he was the driver, my man.
Yes. Yeah. That's all we know him. We know him from for the Bronco chase, even though like
he drove the hell out of that Bronco.
Before that, he played football with OJ Simpson for 20 years. Like they were on the same high school team together. That's how long of a friendship they had, OJ and AC. But yeah, now everybody just knows them for the Bronco chase.
Pro follow on Twitter, OJ Simpson. Hilarious. Oh, funny guy.
I'm sure he's got so much to say now.
I'm going to get a cameo for him advertising Talking Simpsons.
Oh, God, no. From Simpson to another. I love this show.
This podcast is a killer. Not like me.
Oh, God. But then it cuts back to Bart and Lisa. They have posed a bunch of dogs playing poker together. I think it takes a little long, but it is a funny visual gag.
The bulldog forgot to ante, made me laugh.
Though Nelson should have won with this stolen photo, you know? Or, Bart and Lisa shouldn't give up. They should be like, let's see if we can submit ours first and prove we're first in this, you know? Don't give up there. Meanwhile, Bart just wants to dump spaghetti on Maggie's head, which it's funny. It's the funnier of the two. Bart forgets there's a contest.
Yeah, I like that.
Then it cuts to Homer shopping in the Quickie Mart, and we get a joke about Alestra potato chips. Anybody remember these?
Yes. I think it was like a sort of a fat substitute kind of thing. But I think what happened was, and I have like some research on this, is that it was not actually making people sick. It was the fact that people thought they could eat more because there was less fat, and those habits were making them shit themselves.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay. Man,
I remember there was a brand called Wow, or I think it was Lay's Wow Doritos Wow, and I remember the phrase anal leakage coming out, and as soon as people heard that, I think that was the end of Olestra.
Yeah, they needed a warning label on their chips until 2003, and after that, the FDA did a study and was like, you don't need a warning label anymore, and I can read you like a little quote about this. The FDA cited a six-week study of more than 3,000 people showing that the Olestra eating group experienced only a small increase in bowel movement frequency compared to the control group, and they concluded that subjects eating Olestra-containing chips were no more likely to report having had loose stools, abdominal cramps, or any other GI symptom compared to subjects eating an equivalent amount of regular potato chips.
So it was just that they were eating too many potato chips in general, and it was fucking up their guts.
They're just like, well, I'm losing by not eating all these chips. So,
I guess, Nick, you're right. Once you can just say, once the anal leakage stuff hits the news headlines, whether it's true or not, you're done for as a potato chip.
It did make your stools fattier, I will say, but I don't know if that really matters.
I feel like I had some, I only ate a couple bags of these regularly, and when they were around until the news started coming out, and in my memory I feel like I had some bad toilet experiences, but it honestly could have just been fully psychosomatic, or I mean, also I was a 17-year-old kid who ate any garbage in his face, so I don't, it probably was unfair to blame the Olestra potato chips. And now it's baked Lay's that are the big deal. Anyway, they've replaced those as the low fat chips.
Ooh, I could go for a bag of those. Those are my airport staple. Bag of baked Lay's.
They're not healthy, but they make you think they are.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm looking for.
Also, 13 months after this is when Futurama would do their Olestra joke.
Oh, what was that?
They're walking by a dump and they're digging up old stuff. Fry says, hey, a bag of Olestra potato chips. Bender eats one and literally shits a brick. But Homer wants his to do spring cleaning, which... get one of your favorite pina colonics, Homer. So Homer and Barney then run into each other. Homer's buying beer and he's feeling defensive about buying it when he runs into Barney. Then he's leaving without paying, and Apu really should not let Homer back into the store after he steals that. He sent Marge to prison for doing less.
It's true. Well, Homer's finally, his wish is coming true to rob the Quickie Mart.
You're right.
Without a gun.
Homer walking out with two six-packs does seem like a lot of beer for one evening for just Homer, since Marge clearly doesn't drink anything. But yes, Bart and Lisa, meanwhile, are going exploring, taking photographs, and starting fires.
Boy, you can see everything from Mount Springfield, the Squid Port, the old monorail, the Play-Doh factory.
Crescent Moon! Crescent Moon!
Come on, Springfield. Sparkle for me, baby. That's it. Heads up!
Ow! Barge, that's hot.
I said heads up.
It's good Big Brother talk of, I said heads up.
Yeah, and this episode is 2020. We've got helicopter crashes and forest fires happening here.
Oh, God.
In this episode. But yeah, Bart should be punished.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they started a fire. Like, you would think at least responsible Lisa would be like, don't litter, Bart. But I guess she's still just in pain from getting, like, a flash bulb in her head. I mean, at least it's a clever, old-timey way to start a fire of, like, they use an old camera that where the flash is a bulb you have to replace every single time in, like, what, 1940s style? Like, it's a very ancient camera. And the shot of the whole city, I really like that. Like, I think the squid port she mentioned, that's the boardwalk from the Lisa Babysitter episode.
Yeah.
And just hearing them wink back at the monorail, I feel like this is their first reference looking backwards at the monorail since then, I think. Hmm. Not counting monorail appearing as in a clip show. I think this is
I think you're right.
And what it was like last year or the year before in an episode, they revitalized the monorail as like a new downtown area. And they even had a statue in tribute to Leonard Nimoy, which that was the weirdest part. It's like, oh, so everyone's the same age, but you recognize that Leonard Nimoy has died since the last time.
Only celebrities age in the Simpsons universe.
And the Play-Doh factory joke's okay, but I like that all the gay steel steel mill guys are there.
And it's the same buzzer from the steel mill as well.
Yes. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, that sort of saved the joke for me because, again, it was feeling a little Family Guy with the non sequitur there, but that sort of breaks reality. But then when you saw the steel mill guys, that sort of made it.
Yeah, actually, that Play-Doh factory joke would be exactly the same in Family Guy, like unchanged.
Yeah.
I guess it's also poetic justice that Bart and Lisa almost die in a fire they started, I suppose. But yeah, the casual nature with which they treat forest fires in here does strike me as somebody living in California now, where fires are very serious and happen every year at least and ruin everything. But in here, they kind of treat it as like, oh, it's a thing that threatens two kids. And once it's over, they're out, they're fine.
Just stays on that mountain. It's fine.
Yes, we come back to the bar. And as Homer is trying his best to befriend his bullies, Barney returns.
Lenny, Carl, I know a lot of people badmouth you and focus on how you suck. But not me. To me, you're true blue.
Aw, thanks, big guy.
Now dance, Rummy.
Okay.
Hi, Mo.
Well, if it isn't Little Miss, I'm not wasting my life anymore. Which he is.
Mo, I've come here to make amends for my disgraceful behavior over the last 20 years.
No, that's okay, Bond.
No, it's not okay. I broke bar stools, befouled your broom closet, and made sweet love to your pool table, which I then befouled.
Well, that would explain the drop-off in play.
This is a Channel 6 news bulletin. Fire has broken out on Mount Springfield, trapping two youngsters and their camera.
Oh, no. That's Bart and Lisa.
Unfortunately, fire trucks are unavailable to fight the blaze as they're all being used to film the new Burt Reynolds movie, Fireball and Mudflap. I caught up with Burt on the set.
I at least like the transition that Kent's talking about a natural disaster and then goes like, I caught up with him on the set.
It's got a nice segue. And I guess Dan and Deb wrote Burt Reynolds into the original script. He was going to be like at AA to research for a role. So maybe they thought in 92 or whatever, they could get Burt Reynolds. Obviously, this is Hank Azaria. And I like how Fireball and Mudflap aren't two characters.
That's great.
His full name.
That's right. I play Fireball Mudflap. That's
You can see a bit of the poster, too, behind him in the press junket thing that Brockman is at.
It implies that Burt Reynolds in his, you know, a career resurgence post Boogie Nights is like, you know what, I'm going to make another of the 70s style films I got to make, but in the year 2000. That befouling of the pool table, that I like that because it, okay, so he just says he befouled the broom closet, meaning he, I guess, defecated in it. But when he says he makes sure to say that he can make sweet love to a pool table and then befoul it. The making sweet love is not befouling the table. Which also makes it sound like he rubbed his genitals on it and then defecated on it.
I think he ejaculated.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, all right. So the befouling is the ejaculation.
In one of the several holes, yeah.
Okay.
Not to get too crude here, but just to paint a picture for everybody at home.
It's a horrifying
picture. No, let's dig into this. Let's figure it out. I saw it the same way you did, Henry, where he ejaculated and then defecated in one of the pockets. But who knows? That'll be one of those mysteries you'll have to, if you ever get Dan on the show.
That explains the drop-off in play.
That's the first question we asked Dan Castellaneta. How was it befouled? it is a good story excuse to get Barney back into the bar so him and Homer would be forced together in a crisis, like having Barney do the 12-step apology thing. I don't think I've ever gotten a 12-step apology to from somebody because
I'm owed several.
I think of my friends who went into AA from my early 20s. I moved away before they all did that, so I missed out on it. I was out of town. They honestly should have used MySpace in 2005 to do the apology then. I'm owed one.
There's probably
say.
Some sort of e-card for that, right?
12-step e-card. So yes, Homer and Barney, they're going to go save the kids because there's no firefighters to do it. And Homer's saying, like, will you accept the charges? It's a little too earnest to me. I feel like there's, like, one extra joke missing there, you know, of just him picking up a phone and saying, will you accept the charges?
I think the joke is that it's calling collect.
I see. All right, yeah, okay.
Yeah, it kind of fell flat for me, too, but... Yeah, I know what you're saying. It felt like there should be a button on top of that button.
At least do a 1-800-COLLECT reference. It's the year 2000. Just go for
it. What's Chris Rock doing?
I only trust David Arquette. If he tells me to use a number, I'm doing that one. Somehow Barney gets the chopper without the instructor and is just flying alone, which I don't... did he steal that helicopter? Does Barney somehow own a helicopter now?
Well, that's how successful he is now. Just comb your hair and tuck in your shirt, people. It can happen to you.
There seems to... this makes some sense if you imagine that Barney is, like, independently wealthy somehow, or, like, he's a trust fund kid or something, because otherwise he never has a job or anything. But, yeah, so they fly off, but... Barney is too nervous to do the flying, and he's, you know, the stress is making him tempted again, and Homer does a really heroic thing for his good buddy.
Beer! That's what I need! Barney! No! Don't! Yes! I need it! No! You've got to be sober for this! Give me that! It's warm. You can't drink them all! Oh, yes, I can! Give me that! I won't let you give up now. When you've worked so hard to be the greatest pal in the world, I love you. Let's not lose touch after graduation. You brave man. You took 6 silver bullets for me. Stay away from my wife. Looks like it's up to me.
Homer becomes like every kind of drunk in this scene, too.
Yeah. You know, we've seen a lot of good drunk voice acting by Castellaneta, but he does a really good job here, too, with a lot of good, funny, drunken non sequiturs to say. And that silver bullets thing, that's about how apparently it's that Coors in 1959 was the first American company to use aluminum cans, which made their can silver, which was different from everybody else at the time.
Cardboard. Didn't last long on the shelves.
And so that's why they specifically got called silver bullets. But even in 2000, I think calling alcohol silver bullets was an old reference. I think this is, I mean, I didn't know. I never heard a friend refer to them as silver bullets.
Just Coors in general.
Yeah, just we're all very brand focused in America. You just call something by a
brand
name.
Only drink craft IPAs with ridiculous names, so I will not go near a silver bullet. I'm sorry.
I do remember, though, they had hats, Coors hats, like the mesh trucker style caps. Back in the day that had werewolf ears on them because of the whole silver bullet branding. So it apparently took off enough to have merch at one point.
Those are cool. I want this trucker hat with werewolf ears.
It feels weird, though. It's like, I'm going to take a bullet to my mouth. Delicious. Oh, now I'm banned from Twitter. You know who I think should drink Coors? The president. He'd love it.
He'd love it. He needs a silver bullet right now.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway. I do think it's... So this is the turn in the episode that I think in a darker episode or another episode of Simpsons or in South Park even at the time, I think they would have just done the joke of, you know what? Sometimes you do need beer to level out yourself, or like, actually, the beer made him better at it. Like, they do some sort of joke against expectations there. That's also like kind of like we're being naughty saying it's good to drink. But I kind of like instead they went with the emotional thing of like, you know what? Homer is just a good friend who won't let his friend relapse when he's having a moment of problems. Like I like that. It's sweet. And the sweetness is balanced out by Homer doing a bunch of great, funny, drunk lines.
It's also an opportunity to drink for free.
Yeah, that's true. This is the second time this episode he's stolen Duff.
It's a good, I like the resolution to it. I'm always a little bit, whenever The Simpsons becomes kind of an action show, like I'm thinking about the runaway train with the baboons and all, I don't know that it does it that well, because you have to be so heavy on plot then that you can't have the funniest parts of The Simpsons. You know, which are times where there's funny asides or character moments and things like that. So I think it sways a little bit too much into the action set piece resolution for my taste, but it's still getting Homer having to heroically get drunk is a good way to end it.
I guess the monorail episode handled that action joke balance a bit better, yeah. But I do like there's some fun animation of like as they approach the fire rising up and like the Bart and Lisa climbing and Bart saying like I'm pretty sure fire can't climb trees. and then a very like random joke of the bear climbing the ladder. Yeah, which that feels like a network note of show the bear lands safely and does not fall into fire and burn to death.
Or just like break its spine on the ground and die.
I was thinking the exact same thing. Yeah, network note on that one.
It's just like earlier this season where that goat killed all the tobacco executives, but they had to show that the goat lives in that other helicopter crash.
This season is just a helicopter crash season.
Wait a minute.
Well, you know, it's something after playing all those video games that have helicopter crashes in them, it's just like I just noticed them too much and stuff. It's just an easy thing of like I remember seeing the movie Suicide Squad in theaters. And every helicopter in that movie crashes. There's four helicopters and they all explode because they just never, they're just not safe. They're supposed to look safe and then they blow up.
What is your experience with helicopters? Have either of you been up in one?
No, never. I honestly too scared.
Yeah, at this point, no, not going to happen.
Me too. I was going to do it at the Grand Canyon, but it's surprisingly expensive and yeah, it just seems way too scary to me.
I have had those. I've had the temptation moments like that of walking down the strip in Las Vegas the few times I've been there and seeing the like Grand Canyon tour thing, and you consider it for just a second, but yeah, I mean, you know, after the tragic passing of say Kobe Bryant and the other people who were in that helicopter, it was just further reminder of the dangerousness of it. Plus, you can't even have a conversation in there unless you have like a headset on. It's all too loud. I don't need that noise. I'd rather ride a donkey through the Grand Canyon.
Now we're talking.
I feel like that would hurt my legs a lot, though. I don't know. Maybe I'm against that as well. I think. But hey, when will we ever go to Las Vegas again? At this point,
never. No.
but yeah, so there is some. It's at least some well done animation on the action of Homer in a very like cartoony drunk way, falling out of the helicopter and spinning around it and hanging by his leg. He saves Bart and Lisa. And I think Bart and Lisa are very relaxed for being held by like one hand by a drunken upside down guy.
Yeah.
They should be more like, please stop moving, Dad. You don't. No. But yes, Bart and Lisa are saved. And Homer, this is my favorite line of the episode here, too, of Homer.
You did it, Dad.
You can't prove I did it.
No, you saved our lives.
I could do a lot of things if I had some money.
What? Now there's a picture. Kids! The new phone books are here, and your picture's on the cover!
Oh, wow! Cool! Let me see!
Isn't it adorable? I guess some baby pictures were on that old roll of film.
Oh, we'll be the laughingstock of the whole town.
Well, at least we won the bike.
Actually, I took the picture, so I gave my prize to the orphanage.
What? How could you?
Just kidding. I would never do that.
Apparently that just kidding line was added by Julie at the table read, and they thought it was so funny that they kept it in the episode. So.
That's great.
That is a good ad lib.
I mean, I also love that. I loved in the commercial that you knew it was a bike the second they showed the mystery prize. I gotta think Bart and Lisa destroy. They just can't share that bike, and it only causes them more problems. But I mean, first off, why would the phone book want to have a picture of a forest fire on their cover? That seems like a bummer. Who'd want to see that? But now
we're looking at children on the toilet. Come on.
Yeah, that's was just cute then. But I do like, you know, Marge is actually right. She says your picture's on the cover, and it is a picture of them on the cover. It's a fun wordplay. Also, you notice that the phone book mail was delivered by the woman that Mo was photographing earlier in the episode.
You're right. Holy crap.
Nice detail. I like that. Didn't notice it.
It all pays off.
Also, when Bart and Lisa scream in reaction, it's a classic, like, big mouth, wavy lip kind of scream. You don't see as... I miss those old screams. Thumbs up to Neil Affleck and his team for keeping those classic style screams in there. But yes, we come to the happy ending for Barney, as he has not relapsed, but is the cure worse than the disease?
Well, I'm glad we're friends again.
Yeah. So what do you call this stuff?
A double tall mocha latte.
It's not bad.
Well, it ain't beer. Well, at least I got that monkey off my back.
Nobody gets away from Mo. Nobody.
You know, just a few years ago, Mo did say that ice blended mocha drinks were in.
Oh, that's right.
And he's ready. But I'm just concerned about all the empty calories Barney is consuming, perhaps more than even beer with all those double mocha lattes.
That's right. You're
Black
right,
coffee's yeah. where it's at.
This feels very 1999, a mocha frappuccino latte. though apparently it was slightly inspired by Dave Merkin, writer on the show, himself giving up alcohol and then being addicted to caffeine instead as a replacement.
It's a healthy addiction, I tell you.
Keeps you on edge, you're ready for things.
Yeah, short temper, high blood pressure. I just need a reason to get out of bed in the morning, and my addiction is what it is. It's like that first drop of coffee makes me know I'm alive.
Yeah, it's funny how addictions they transfer over, and yeah, coffee's probably a little healthier. Or I know a lot of former addicts who are now not only like running marathons, but like super marathons and Ironmans, and it's like... In a way, that's more annoying than alcoholism to me.
Oh, that's irritating.
It's just irritating. I get it. You're healthy, but you're still addicted to something, and quit rubbing my nose in it.
I feel like as soon as I enter my 30s, all these people around me were like entering triathlons and stuff. Like, listen, we're going to die. You can't stop it. It's a hell of a toboggan ride.
You know, I live a pretty caffeine-free life myself. It's the healthiest thing about me. I have improved my diet a little bit in the last few months, but just I don't like the taste of coffee. And then but I also don't like drinking the milkshake versions of it either. Mm. So it just, I wake up in the morning, I'm like, hey, it's the morning. All right. Like, yeah.
I don't understand you people.
I know. See, I never acquired the coffee taster, but let me ask you this, Bob. How did you get into coffee? Was it through the sugarier drinks and then you transitioned to black coffee?
You know what? It was actually just starting with black coffee because I was on I was going to college in Northeast Ohio, and it was like freezing. Like, it's just so cold in the winter and the campus is huge and you're outside for like 20 minutes walking between classes. And like in every building is this little kiosk selling you hot liquid. And that is how I got a taste for coffee. And also I was like, oh, this will keep me awake as well and make me alert. So I got to like coffee through that. And basically the only coffee I like is black coffee. I don't like anything in it. I think it's a sacrilege to like sully it with creams and sugars. Just black coffee for me. But yeah, it was just like hot. It was like, oh, hot brown on
hot
a cold
brown.
Day.
Yeah, I would get I went with chai tea, which was more palatable to me, but also has three times the sugar if it's like a latte. So I do drink those occasionally. That's kind of my caffeine fix.
And I didn't even know, like, I probably would have started drinking coffee earlier, but like occasionally I'd have a cup of coffee like my parents were drinking, and I'd be like, oh, this is disgusting. But then I realized over time, like, oh no, they just drink disgusting coffee. Like every boomer has a can of like Folgers or Maxwell House, the most vile. It's barely coffee. It's just gross.
Maybe that's why I only associated coffee with that. And then once I had real coffee, I was like, I guess it's okay. But the last time I think I ever drank coffee was like 4 years ago when I was covering the New York Comic Con for a website. And I was like, oh, I need extra energy today. And 3 hours later, after I just drank one mocha frappa latte, after drinking just one of those, I was shaking and I couldn't stop shaking my arms. I was like, what's going on? I feel like I'm going to have a heart attack. Oh, I had one coffee. That was what happened.
My friends who were in AA and come over for like board game nights, it'll be like 9 o'clock at night and they'll have like two iced coffees and they won't even be feeling any effect from it. It just doesn't have any effect. And it just, you know, keeps them awake a little bit, but it doesn't make them shake, nothing like that. They've acquired an immunity.
I also, one of those, if you read it too realistically, it's very dark. Homer having to have a flask of liquor to pour in beer, coffee, is like, I cannot drink straight coffee. Homer simply can't do it. Like, that's very dark.
Yeah, the secret flask is never a good sign.
And
I do like the ending with, you know, the evil Mo. I always like the unnecessary, like, you know, mustache twirling. Or like when they zoom in on the koala's dead eye, you know, in the Australian episode. I don't know. I always think that if you can't find a great ending, that's a nice little hook at the end.
And I do think it's at least their closest to resetting that they can do without having Barney be drunk anymore, because like he still burps, he still has some addiction problem, and because Mo now owns a thing that makes coffee, Barney will still be in the bar. But I mean, that's why he fell off the wagon. He's still staying in the bar every day. Like, come on.
I mean, like, most of the bars I go to or used to go to would always have like a pot of coffee brewing behind the bar, usually for the people that work there, but I assume you could drink that if you asked for it. I need to sober up and then drive.
That doesn't actually work.
No, it doesn't.
No, but
it puts coffee on top of the alcohol in your stomach.
That's also a very 1950s drunk way of thinking, like, get him some coffee, get on a pot. That episode is interesting for a exploration of the character of Barney and having a somewhat realistic, like, borders on, just like How Alone Again Natural Diddly, I think, bordered on being a very special episode about, like, grief, but then was like, nah, we don't really want to do that. This is kind of that for Barney of, like, okay, is this actually a very special episode about the struggles of sobriety, or is this crazy and funny? Like, they kind of have it both ways in the show, which can lead to some off-kilter stuff. But I guess the more I engage with this episode about sober Barney, it makes me feel retroactively bad a bit about laughing at him. And also it makes me feel worse that he like falls off the wagon and they're just done with it. And they're like, you know what? No, he's drunk.
We had 3 years of Simpsons of sober Barney from here on out. So like 18 months of our podcast.
Yeah. I mean, what does that say? It is, though. It's kind of like how you want Marge wanted Itchy and Scratchy to be less violent, and then everyone hated the non-violent version, so they immediately went back. It's just funnier to have a drunk Barney.
I guess they didn't follow their own advice based on the episode.
they make a great comment on the commentary, I think, when they talk about how they had him go back. And Mike Scully says, like, let that be a lesson to you, kids. You're more funny when you're drunk, so just stay drunk.
It's true. So, Nick, thanks for being on the show with us. Please, once again, plug everything you're doing right now, including the new documentary.
Yeah, the documentary is called A Life on the Farm. We're hoping to finish it and have it out next year. And you can find all of our stuff at foundfootagefest.com, including our weekly YouTube show called VCR Party.
And hopefully we can see you guys touring again whenever that happens. We want to tour as well, by the way. I personally missed like 4 events in the past 6 months. So it sucks for all of us live performers.
I know. So in the meantime, hopefully more outdoor shows and, you know, we'll hunker down this winter and be back in the spring.
Well, hopefully. But yeah, it's always awesome to have you on here, Nick. So thanks so much for coming back.
Yeah, guys, it's been a glum year. It's been glummy. but your podcast has really kept people like me going. So
thank you
for continuing to do what you do as well.
Oh, thanks.
So thanks again to Nick Prueher of Found Footage Fest for being on the show. Check out Found Footage Fest and also check out the new documentary upcoming, Life on the Farm. The Kickstarter for that has long been over at this point, but you can still check it out, watch the trailer, see what that's all about. But as for us, if you want to check out more of our stuff and get all these episodes 1 week ahead of time and ad-free, please go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. And if you sign up there, you'll get just that, but also access to everything behind the $5 paywall. That is everything we've been doing behind the paywall for over 3 years at this point. That includes all of our limited miniseries. The most recent one that's happening right now is Talking Futurama Season 2 Part 2, wrapping up the second half of Futurama's second season using the Talking Simpsons treatment, and the previous Talking Futurama episodes are all on the Patreon behind the $5 paywall at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. And there is so much other stuff happening behind that paywall, too many things to list here, but we also have a $10 tier. You sign up for that, you get all the $5 stuff, but also one mega long podcast once a month for patrons of that level or higher. higher. And Henry, what is that?
Why, Bob, you're talking about the What a Cartoon Movie podcast. On the What a Cartoon podcast, we talk about a different animated series each week. And for What a Cartoon Movie, we do the same thing for an animated feature film each month. We've covered films as diverse as Space Jam, The Black Cauldron, Akira, and right before this one, the Aladdin Return of Jafar sequel. And this... Well, actually, I guess in October we did a different one, but that hasn't been decided at the time of this recording. But the important thing to know is that you get all of that $5 stuff Bob just mentioned, and you get the What a Cartoon Movie back catalog, and each month a new one. Over 100 hours, 2 years worth of episodes are at your fingertips if you sign up at the $10 level or increase your $5 pledge to $10 a month at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
So as for me, I've been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo, and my other podcast, by the way, is Retronauts. That is a classic gaming podcast about old video games. You can find that wherever you find podcasts, or go to patreon.com/retronauts for 2 exclusive episodes every month. Henry, how about you?
You should follow me, Henry Gilbert, on Twitter at HENEREYG. I'm certain I'm saying some stuff right now is the time you're listening to this. You can stay in the loop there. Also, you really should be following the official Twitter account of this podcast at TalkSimpsonsPod. At TalkSimpsonsPod. That keeps you up to date whenever new things happen in our podcast. Whenever a new thing goes up on the free feed for this or What a Cartoon, whenever stuff goes up on the Patreon, whenever we have a poll to pick the next thing we're going to do, we always tweet about that and other cool stuff at Talk Simpsons Pod on Twitter.
Thanks so much for joining us, folks. We'll see you next time for Kill the Alligator and Run, and we will see you then.
If you're in business, you probably have a website, but can your site handle your growth? How many visitors before your site slows down or crashes? What about storage and data security? From web hosting to virtual servers, Pear Networks provides the online infrastructure you need to start, grow, and flourish. When it comes to security and updates, don't worry, we've got you covered. Our 24/7 US-based customer support is the best in the industry. No frustrating chatbots or sitting on hold for hours. Check out pear.com today to learn more. That's PAIR.com.